Jason's gonna make me go over this again.
Good. Don't even mention it. I'll play it with you.
Nikki's and mom, we need to start we'd like with to that. Apologize.
Yeah.
Yes, we do need to send our apologies to Nikki's mom. I will say.
I can't wait to do like a compilation video of all the sorry, Nikki mom. Sorry Nikki's mom.
Yes.
So sorry. That's on my to-do list.
I'm sure that's what you're I was gonna say, have you started doing any
Yes, and do you have any idea how complicated Premiere Pro is?
That's why I don't ever use this stuff.
I'm learning it, so we'll see. We'll see how long it takes.
Do your thing. Take your time. Cool. We didn't lose you that long there, right, Nick? So
it was very brief.
Okay.
I've hit that button so many times. That was the first time I accidentally hit the wrong button.
Well, let's see where we last left off in the campaign. After saving, after destroying the Hydra, Polykranos, the party flew back, which only took them, you know, maybe half a day to go back to on their trusty steeds, flying steeds, back to the Temple of Purphoros. They spent, I think, about a week time in the city, and Mati, a lot of things have been happening. Like, so there's been, you know, Taroxes is probably proud to see that there is a lot more reverential, a pilgrimage of people coming up to worship. The temple's coming together very quite nicely. You have, Mati has different priests who are working with them. And in that time, unfortunately, though, we had lost, Proxenos was already gone, but we're waiting for him hopefully to come back. Apodexis fell, Apex fell in battle, those two. And Pythias had fallen in battle. Pythias has become part of the Nyx, part of the, one of the constellations of the sky, looking down over the party. Apex body fell when the temple was attacked by returned who were seeking Proxenos's body. Fitz got some comeuppance, got some revenge on what's his name? Barrowman. And the party went in the night, and while Taroxes had gone to pray to Purphoros to seek guidance, and they took on his Minotaur guards, and they chased him through his secret passageway and beat him to a bloody pulp, and then took him prisoner, which they still have, which we'll find out what they decide to do with him today. You know, I know that's a really quick kind of spin through, and it's kind of even out of order because they did Brahman first, but is anything else you guys want to like throw in there that to bring us up to speed?
We did have Ohan's character. So Ohan showed up for that.
Oh yes, Nazari. So yeah, I don't think. Yeah. Oh yeah, Nazari. Ohan's not here tonight. I think Ohan's gonna miss tonight. Okay. But we'll get him in next time. He's a satyr, shadow monk, who also took a level, I think, in cleric now. And then we've just also met Persis. Do you want to tell the party? You want to remind us a little bit about Persis, Colin?
Persis was commanded by Purphoros to come and aid you all. She owes something to him and generally obeys orders. She appears to be like kind of a straight shooter and not that humorous. Wants to help. I think she might have been confused by your actions a little bit. But since you all convinced her that you're the authorities, she was fine with it. Physical description, Persis is a Triton, wearing just mostly like regular street clothes, sometimes has a bronze pseudo-dragon with her. Yeah.
Nice.
And gotten, I think it was more like one-sided, the whole like mage duel with between her and Telmoon, But there was a little competition there to see who could do the most damage.
And yes, so we have introduced Persis. Leto the Mad, I know you're out for some games, so we had Leto go into the city and kind of do some things on his own, so he's just arriving back. Before we start today's episode, I know that we talked a little bit about kind of moving the story ahead a little bit. There's been a lot of lore that you've learned about Nylea and her Araka, her companion who was turned into a beast by well, my names are crazy tonight, but by the god of deception,
Phoenix.
And I still got some COVID brain. And so let me get Tyne in here. And so there's been some thought of like, what do we tackle next? And one of the things was that going after trying to free her companion, you know right now that it's a red bird or a goose, and you remember coming across that creature once before. If Phoenix, if you are to go after the creature, and Phoenix shows up, Nylea, through legend, reveals that there are at least six. You don't have to have all of them, but there are these arrows that she used to best Phoenix once before, and the party knows multiple locations. And since they are headed back, they decided to go to Oreskos first to lay to rest Apex. They thought they would stop by the Sun Mirror, where that's one of the locations that would have that arrow. They also know that Tyrannica, the monarch or the queen of Akros, has headed down to the Dark Gates, which is also at the north end of Oreskos, and she is fighting there these dark forces that are coming in possibly from another land. So the party's like, well, we can go to Oreskos, we can hit Apo's family, then we can hit Sun Mirror, and then we can go up there and help her, if I'm not mistaken. The raid on Barrowmons, so far the next day, you're not hearing any accusations that anything looks fishy or that the bronze bullies did anything. As of right now, the word from the city guard is, and the word on the street is that people believe that Posse Barrowmon, you know, either got hit by another gang or there was an uprising and things went wrong. They haven't really figured out what happened, but no one has been pointing. None of the fingers or the awareness has gone back to the bronze bullies. There was one Minotaur who got away. And also to bring it up, so Taroxes would probably be happy about this, but Telmoon found a bunch of slaves who were being kept by Barrowmon, and he burned them in their pens, and they just wanted to be free. And
they're free now.
His sword has hence stopped talking to him, his sentient being, and it distrusts him, which he doesn't. It doesn't matter because of his level and his power. So those are just some of the things, yeah, that have transpired.
Yeah, and if I'm allowed to quick rewind, I would have probably asked Taroxes to help me forge like a more vicious stabber, like an S-stock or a rapier. Because my pansy family rapier doesn't want to talk to me right now, so that's going to get carried on the back. So he's just going to have a regular non-magical rapier that he carries around right now, because yeah.
Fair enough.
If possible, if you'll allow Dia for us.
I'll allow that. Alright. Yeah, so I think that's everything. As Leto the Mad is shown back up in the temple, we're still not starting the game. I'm kind of still doing preliminaries. So Leto shows back up. Taroxes appears on that morning before you all, you know, get to the leave while you're also gathering information. Maybe even Leto's the one who's bringing the information back, like, hey, you hear about this thing? Barrowmon's dead. You know, he's telling you all the stuff he heard about. You guys are probably telling him, yeah, that was kind of us, you know, all those kind of conversations are being had. But also, Taroxes, when you come back, and I would normally give this over to you and let you roleplay, but I'm just going to, like, Taroxes has this word, and what he shares is that the god of the forge, Purphoros, informed him that the bullies need to leave the temple with haste. He does not give a time, he does not give a day or an hour, but he says soon. Soon Purphoros will need to call on all of his power to defeat Heliod. And in doing so, Purphoros' surge, the power that he will call on, will cause Mount Velus to erupt. Now, Purphoros wants to protect the temple. It's one of his oldest temples, and he thanks the group for what they've done to it, to keep it there. But even if he can protect the temple, it will not be safe for the mountain to be erupting, to be on it. So he has commanded Taroxes to tell Mati and the other priests, those who have survived, to teleport away, stay away from the temple for some time until he calls them back. They will then go to those other flame speaker towers that are scattered around the base of the mountain. Hopefully Akros will not be in jeopardy, but Purphoros does not speak to that when he shares this with Taroxes. He does share that he wants Taroxes to keep the hammer because he has developed a new weapon that could be a god killer or a god weakener. And it is not as strong or durable as his hammer, and it is likely to shatter after being used. But he declares that when the time is right, he will send for the bronze bullies once again. So what we'll do from that is we will kind of start some preliminary role-playing before we head out. You guys just let me know when you're prepared to head out to Oreskes. And I'll turn it over to you all.
Where would Baramon be at this time?
You brought back bloodied and bruised and still tied up on one of your Pegasus.
Yeah, you probably just tied up in a Pegasus pen. Just lying in some manure.
Yes. Yes, in a Pegasus pen.
Okay with that.
So yeah, what you all, that's another thing, what you decide to do with him is up to you as well.
Throw him in the lava.
Yeah. No, this is going to explode. We could just leave him here.
He could literally just be like, you get to be the keeper of the temple now. That's your punishment. And we're all going to leave, and you have to be here alone and then die in a fiery death. Although he would probably escape.
Not if he's chained up to a wall.
He also has only one arm.
Yeah. Oh, yes, yeah. We forgot. It's took
definitely
his...
took his arm off.
It's definitely...
I thought it was the fingers. No, you took the arm? Took the whole hand?
It was the whole hand.
It started with the fingers, and then yeah. I think I elevated it to be like, break his arms!
And then Apodexus got a little carried away.
Yes, okay. That's what happened.
It was really chaotic.
So he's got a nub for sure.
This is a lot of information for Proxenos the process.
Yes, and Proxenos has just come back after
making his up and around.
He is up.
Proxenos has also seen that everyone else who has died, he knows that they have joined his father in battle down in the underworld.
He would also let you know that Phoenix is trying to destroy the underworld. And if he succeeds, all of the glory of going to Elysium, everyone there is going to disappear. And it's imperative that we stop it.
That's not good. But when Proxenos gets back to the temple, Taroxes will very casually tell your mother to take a long vacation from the city and informs everyone about what's happening, obviously. Don't know if it'll be safe. I'm not terribly concerned either way, but she may not want to be there.
I think it's good to keep the people aware. I will.
If you'd like.
I'll go to her myself. I'm sure that. Sure that she would like to see me walking around alive.
And so.
I prefer you that way.
Thank you.
And I'm sure that day Proxenos visits his mother. And I imagine that at first she's almost like, you know, she knows what the party told her. She knows that this day would and could come, you know, but she is kind of at a loss for words to see you up and alive again. But then she rushes and embraces him, kissing him on his forehead, and strangely looking at you, like, she tells you, you look, something about you is different.
I saw my father again back in Elysium.
Pintos?
Yes.
How is he doing? I'm sure he looks great.
Yes. Yes, he is. And just as I remember him, true hero, champion, fighting to save the underworld now. There's truly no rest for him.
I'm glad you are back to rejoin your friends. They need you more than ever.
And I'll need their help with the grand changes that are going to be happening in Theros. I can feel it. Looking to the sky where the Nyx is and the images that sometimes you can see the gods. I fear that there'll be a true reckoning upon this land.
I believe you, my son. But whatever is meant to be, I know that you and your brother will be part of great things. I have not told you, but he has head to Adunos. He has been gone for some time now with his regimen. But I have heard no poor, ill word, and so I hope the best. And like you, when he left, looked different. And I think Heliod is keeping him.
A bit of a mixed emotions on Proxenos's face.
Mm-hmm.
And I know, and I'm proud that he's fighting to save and stop the Murder King. There's so much that needs to be done all at once.
Yes. I will be here, as you know I am now, on the council until Tyrannica returns. We have many decisions to make in case war comes to Akros. It has not come to that. We do not believe it will. We hope Tyrannica returns soon. I hear you and yours, the bullies, are headed that direction. Hopefully you can check on her well-being and provide us an update soon.
Yes. And keep an eye on the mountain.
We will. Perforos seems distant these days. But Iroas is with us. And I imagine him and his mother can have plenty more come, but back, he's able to teleport into like that father's office, speak with her. What's maybe the rest of the party doing or deciding back at the temple? Leto, is there anything else that he would maybe have added of what he's been up to in the city? And I don't know if he's a gambler. I don't know. I will say, Leto, the at least for this week, it's been for the Mad. It's been kind of nice that the gods have not been screaming in his ear. A lot of that bombardment of voices and oracle-like channeling, it's kind of just been gone for a while. But he knows, it's not like you're, he knows his connection is true, but there hasn't been much chatter. It's been kind of quiet.
He probably just wandered around the streets of Akros, pickpocketing the higher ups and just trying to get the scoop on what's going down in the city, mostly.
Yeah. Sure. Apple, how have you been knowing that you have your uncle's body? Or are you the uncle? Like, you're the...
He was the uncle's body.
He
probably would have spent the week preparing it, making sure all.
Well,
of
it's actually only been a day. You were in the town a week before they attacked, so it's just been less than a day.
Okay,
but less than a day. So yeah, so you still have a fresh corpse on hand.
In that case, just swatting the flies off of it with my tail. But prepare, you know, getting ready to prepare it so that the family would be able to see it, and then deciding
the priest would gentle repose it once the same thing they were doing to Proxenos, though there's only a couple of them that survived the night, but they will help out with that.
Ending whatever gear he would have, you know, repairing anything that would need repairing, and then just trying to come to grips with the fact that I'm going to have to go back looking like an anvil rot, which may or may not go well.
Yeah, I have decided that the village you're from, the pride, or the your den, the prides of the Oreskan lands, you and Apex would know that they're often nomadic, they're often moving like giant. They set up huge tent-like cities and then break them down. But there are some installations that are longer lasting, and those are built into the side of mountains. And Baos is where you are both from. And it is very close to Tethmos. Tethmos is the capital of Oreskos that is built at the top of the mountain, but there are multiple little dens scattered along, and yours is one of the ones closest to the bottom of the rocky structure there in the valley that you'd be heading to when you're ready. And I'd also wonder, are the bronze bullies, because I know I originally said we were heading to the Sun Mirror, but thinking about Apex and Apo, would Apo take Apex back first, or would he head to the Sun Mirror first? These are another decision the party can decide to make.
I mean, Apple would like everyone to come.
Mm-hmm. What are like your burial rites? Like, do you set him on fire and then take the bits back? Do you bury him? What are your traditions? Do you guys like eat each other when you die? Is that horror? I don't know. What do you guys do?
We throw a 3-day long celebration of the one who has fallen, and then we inter them into the crypts within the walls.
Are your celebrations very much like Bardstock?
Very much not like Bardstock. But there are great games and feats of strength that shall occur.
I would be honored to best your people in challenges.
So, does that mean we're carrying the body with us this whole time we're traveling?
You guys haven't started to travel yet. I know.
I'm planning.
Oh yes, you're planning. You would be taking the body, probably wrapping it, carrying it on one of the Pegasus.
Well, I mean, as we have learned Proxenos, it's kind of difficult to travel with a body. Maybe we handle that first. Plus, I could really do for a party. This has been incredibly depressing.
I mean, it's a funeral party, but...
Yeah, but it's a celebration. We... Oh, do you think Apex has action figures? If not, we could totally get one made. You could, like, pull his little arms. And it would say one of his catchphrases.
It is highly possible that he has wooden action figures that are... probably sold in the marketplace in Meletus.
There's probably a whole action line for the wrestling ring.
Yes.
Different colors of makeup for the different seasons.
Oh, you know this. It.
Well, good, because if he didn't have one, I was going to make one.
All right.
So, okay, so we're traveling with one body. Cool. What about that asshole guy with the Pegasus? What are we going
to
do?
You're the one who did that to him? What do you want to do?
Yeah, I mean, I was kind of having a fit of rage and no one really stopped me. And now I don't quite know what to do.
And
also, I totally don't buy that he doesn't know what was going on with the pixies. I'm not listening to you.
And enough has been done to me. Please, I swear, sure, if you release so. Me, I will. My lips are sealed. Haven't I paid enough? I will commit my life to. I'll commit my life to Perforos if need be. I will become a priest here. I will do anything. From here and forth, with my good hand, I commit to the bronze bullies. Please, I don't have to die. I can be valuable as drawing breath.
I cast Thunderclap at him. I was going to be a 16 constitution save.
And he's going to get blasted into the wall. And as she does that, you hear he slams against the wall and there's a crack in his chest and he slumps down and a little
just
bit of blood starts.
Just maybe be quiet for a bit, man. We're trying to figure it out.
And he's making death saves. Yeah, and it was this loud boom.
Say that brown side.
And he doesn't look like he's doing well.
Well, job's done.
Hey, what? What just happened? I can't hear anything.
Oh, I'm sorry, I didn't think about that, you guys. It was just he makes me so mad.
How's Persis doing?
Just looking at this with consternation, like his crimes must have been great.
Yeah.
Genocide.
It's revive him so I can break his legs. He needs to be awake for it.
If he needs to be executed, then why not just finish it now?
Because he was supporting such horrible torture. I don't feel like it's totally fair for us to just put him out of his misery.
Bring him back.
Sure, I'll cast a second level cure wounds.
He doesn't wake up. Every 6 seconds I had made a death save for him and he got to two saves, he got to three, he just got his last fail.
Well, cool.
Then it's done.
I guess I don't have to think too hard about that anymore.
How close are we to the lava pit?
I need to go down to the fortress anyway. Taroxys, can you help me with something?
Yeah. And he's kind of just shudders and breathes like a last sigh and goes out. And so, yeah, there's, you know, no need to worry about him at least anymore. He has expired. Telmoon, you take the body to the lava pit to dispose.
Yeah, I mean, I need to go to the forge anyway. I need to make my stock.
Okay. So I imagine it takes another, you know, day to forge your weapon, or, you know, the part of the day. Fine.
Yeah.
Does Baramon have anything in his pockets?
No, he was running just survival. I think he has a couple of rings on his finger, which are worth,
not actually, anymore.
Yeah.
Did Appendexus eat those, or we got to roll for which hand it was?
Oh.
I won't make you roll for which hand it was, but the rings are, I think, Apple probably, and because he's bronze, it's probably not coming back out, but I think his ring of invisibility was probably on that hand that he chomped off. It might come out. We'll see.
Sure,
it
could come out.
But
that's what Constitution
says. Rings are worth like 150 gold pieces, the couple rings that he has.
Oh, no, that better come out.
No, those are the rings that Fitz is able to take off right now off the other hand. He's got nothing in his pockets. He was pretty much...
He showed up at night.
Yeah, he didn't have anything on him. He didn't have a bag lounging. On him. Yeah.
Anything else was burned.
Yeah.
In like a velour, like sweatsuit, yeah. Like a his long robe. Suit. Yeah. Glass of scotch.
Yep. And so, do we head off for Baos?
Do we have, like, a convenient way to carry a body around? Because all I remember was it was a bit of a struggle. No offense, Proxenos.
Then take him. Thank you.
Are you still a good
He doesn't fit in the bag or anything like that.
He definitely does. He is very large.
I think he's just got too broad a shoulders, you know, to really get him.
Taroxes does have those Icarus wings. I know they're not called the Icarus wings. I can go back in the notes, but he has those. So Taroxes is able to fly on his own, which might free up
some... Not as fast as a Pegasi.
No, so maybe you'll have to take your time a bit. Yeah, but...
We gotta go cross-country. We got time for that. We'll just tie Taroxes to it.
Taroxes looks at you, Fitz, and I did not lose that. Still,
how long does gentle repose last? A week?
I think it lasts a week.
Yeah. Don't worry, I'm still a good cook.
Well, good. I'm glad at least that didn't change.
10 days, so yep.
Got it.
So Leto would like to know, since the ring is inside me, if I'm attuning to it.
Maybe. All right.
We also could have sent Leto. I mean, to go buy us a cart. Not like we can't afford it.
Well, you got three Pegasi. So three horses. I imagine one carries the body with the two satyrs on in some way, shape, fashion, or form. And then you've got, Persis. There's probably another two people that can ride the other one.
Proxenos you, can turn into...
And then Taroxes flies himself. Or what were you going to say? Proxenos can... Yes, actually, Proxenos can turn into...
A giant raven.
Yeah. Giant. So... This should fit everybody fine. If we...
I'm the only one swinging like a wrecking ball.
Well, then maybe that's probably the most respectful way to do it, is to have Proxenos carry the body, because I don't know how well Telmo's going to treat a body that's riding behind him on a...
Giant, have the giant bird. Yeah, I can see that giant bird touch the body. Yeah.
Yeah, I could,
And so... takes the body and then myself a little bit of light here. So the party would probably head out maybe a day later after the rapier is made for Telmoon. And and so they head out maybe mid-morning on that second day to the land of Orescos. And as they travel, it probably takes them 4 or 5 hours. They probably have to stop at least once to let the Pegasi have water, food, that kind of thing. So, but the animals, or these magical beasts, they move with great speed. It gets warmer than usual on the day you enter Orescos, and I think even for Apo, it feels like the sun is shining a bit brighter than it normally does. But for the first time, you all get to see the wonder of those great plains as you enter. And off in the distance, you can see very groups of traveling herds of beasts of burden and elephants and oxen and things like this of this nature. And you from the sky, you begin to see every now and then you even spot Leonin hunters moving amongst the tall grass. But about, like I said, that fourth, fifth hour, you along one of the mountains, you can see the great towers of Tethmos, and they kind of look like great combinations of stone and tent-like cities with glass adornments. And as you dive down low into the valley, you spot Baos, a den. And as you close in, you see the wondrous, colorful tents. Some of these structures are built very, very high, multiple stories high, some of them. Built and then there in the side of a mountain with a waterfall, you see the openings, multiple caves that lead, that Apodexis know, lead deeper inside, that lead to the dens of the Leonin. The Leonin children frolic and play outside, and there's the scattering of like almost safari like land. And then also you notice that for every like regular sized tree, somewhere in the distance there is a tree that is huge. I mean, that is like the size of a building. But here you see Baos. Apodexis, you're taking the lead, I imagine. So as you're coming in and flying in on how... Tell the party how, what they should expect, what they should be prepared for as you kind of coming in hot there.
So he, you see a look of excitement. You can almost see his nostrils flaring. His eyes are much wider as you get to see the plains open up. And right away he tells them, be on the lookout. Archers will be in the tall grass. They are there. You may see them pop out. Do not attempt to look their direction. They may, when we land, come up and sniff you. Allow them to.
And sure enough, the party can spot them moving, setting up position. And before an arrow is released, Apo, you know, they maybe can't make out the fact that you are made of metal, but they can see another Leonin. And so there is a symbol that goes up through one of the humanoids that you see in the grass, stopping the others, that allows you to get in closer than you ever would have normally been with normal outsiders. This attack would have been imminent. I'll turn it back over to you as you land. And you start to see a very large group of Leonin soldiers approaching, some with spears, some with blades out, kind of sniffing at the air, taking their time. So you can kind of hear the kind of growls. To everyone else, it seems extremely almost aggressive behavior and feels like it could be bad. But Apple knows it's just normal operating procedures. Like, these are just, and I don't know what you're doing to kind of show your, showing that you're kind of waving the white flag, that you're not there for any aggression.
He puts his forepaws up, and he's doing like the type of growl that you normally see like big cats do in documentaries, right? It's lower from the throat, and yeah. He just kind of at the end, it's just kind of like almost like the predator, like, and he turns towards the body of Apex, and then walks over to it, hands still, you know, paws still up, and then pulls back the shroud so they can see his face.
So some like kind of low like growls back and forth. And you notice that most of, there are many Leonins around, the children, and many of the those who are on heightened alert, those who have arrows or spears prepared to throw, tend to mostly be female Leonin. So like lowered, they don't have huge manes. And they have kind of like dried markings on their face from some type of maybe like paint or that they've used of earthy texture. And as two large Leonin with large manes come out or enter from like a large, from one of the dens, and they are on both sides of a female Leonin who is decorated and shrouded in multiple colors and adorned in kind of like different pieces of glass and bronze metal that signify certain things. And you can tell, Apo, that this is one of the matriarchs. And what you understand is that there is one monarch, if you want to say the way normal humanoids from outside of Oreskos would see a king. They never call themselves a king. They call themselves the speaker. But the speaker for all of Oreskos changes every year. Right now, that speaker is Brimus. He is the Leonin. But every other pride is run by the matriarchs. And the head matriarch here kind of runs down on all fours and stands up, majestically strides forth with her two guards on either side. You know her to be Mikella. And Mikella stands she seems concerned by seeing Apex. And then she looks at Apo, confused, like she knows another familiar face, but still confused by what has happened, as she slowly walks up without saying a word and just kind of touches and doesn't feel the fluff, doesn't feel the fur, the texture. She can hardly, you can tell she's even struggling to smell your like original scent. Apo, is that you?
It is.
By the gods, what has happened to you?
It was a measure to ensure that the journey did not end.
And Apex, he has finally fallen. I told him to not seek his comfort in the god worshippers in Meletus. But he sought that praise. Did he die in one of their silly shows?
No. He died a warrior's death, and he met the path at the end of the clearing.
And she strokes his brow. That brightens me as much as it saddens me. I always knew he was a greater warrior. I just did not want him to be used in such childish and petty ways. It is good to know that he had the end that he wanted. Who are your friends?
We have come to be known as the Bronze Bullies. We have protected.
We have heard of you. You are a Bronze Bully.
Dun, dun.
The Metal Cat. And then some of the kids are like, that's, you're the Metal Cat? And then, like, they just kind of break it to, Apodexis is one of the Bronze Bullies. And they all can be, you know, hip hip cheer. And as they, like, let out, like, row, they all, like, let out little small cat roars. And then
goes.
And then it kind of blows back on Mikella's mane. And then she lets out one as well. Claws to the sky, and then the rest of the group just erupts in a roar. And from there, it is all good. It is like clearly a welcome as the tension drops with those roars. Bring the body forth. We will have to prepare him for the rituals. But come, relax, and as you walk through this open area of the village, you can see that there are areas where a large boar is being kind of spit roasted, and there's another on the ground. There's a couple of Leonin who haven't waited to, like, they're just eating like scraps of the meat of one of the fresh kill that's not even being cooked. There are some other beasts of burden that are kind of being kept corralled for later use. Others are being made into skins that are being made to be used, to be adorned. And you notice that all of their weaponry seems, from what you remember, Apodex. Now, it's not that the Leonin aren't the greatest of forge masters, right? But they don't forge in the same way. They often use the bones of great animals to forge weapons and spears and things like that. They do some, depending on what den you're in, you know, there's some bronzeware work going. But all these weapons are like, they're a grayish tone, a cleaner, a newer type of metal. So you've probably seen it before, but not as adorned as the entire pride is laid out with it.
And Apodexis, seeing that, would ask the matriarch, that is not what I left with. And he pulls out his, his sickle, which is still almost kind of like chiseled stone.
Yeah. We have been blessed. Right now, the great Brimus is deciding if we shall go to war. We are not one for helping the Acheroans, but we have been told we have been attacked by these hyena men, and lately their war bands are growing in numbers. then we believe Brimus is deciding if we should all go to war, all the prides. You know our people are not for trusting the gods. But months ago, there was a group like your own who came to the Sun Mirror, and it had been cursed. The great shining lake had a fog, a great evil hanging over it. It had become but a swamp. They were able to drive Farrica's curse from the land. They were called themselves the Fleece Mane Lion Company. And what they brought back from their adventure, their extradition, was fruit from a tree, fruit of war. The great Iroas had a tree in that swamp that bore these weapons. And so, groups of these, shipments of these have gone out to all of our people in case we should take them into battle. They are iron. Stronger than the bronze that we were using before. Times are changing, and most Leonins still do not want to do anything for the gods, but we've never turned a gift, we've never been one to not use fine weaponry. And this is fine, and if it can be used to protect our people, then so be it.
My matriarch, if I may be so bold, with the time for not assisting the gods is done. When I left, I had seen several of our pride come back from the underworld. But what is going on now means that we must go to war. There is a war happening in the land of the living, and there is a war for what happens afterward. And we do not have a choice. This should be relayed to Brimus. And I am not one for exaggeration, you know that. But it is not a choice. Because if we do not, then all of this goes away. And he bows, he takes a step back and just takes a moment.
And with this interaction, she seems to have taken that to heart. You can tell that she's like going to think on this. And they take you into this this like shallow, maybe a cave that's no more than like 6, almost 7 feet high. If you're someone like Taroxy, you almost have to kind of lean in and you go in. The deeper you go, there are more stalactites, but it's very wide. It's a very wide opening, so you can see all of the lands out. There's a little fire pit going for foods. There's no need for the fire for warmth right now. It does get quite breezy and cold at night, and it is. So right now your nostrils are filled with the smells of the different meats, as well as some of the raw meats, as some of the textiles, the different things, and as well as just outdoors. And she has a moment for you all to kind of sit around. And is there anything else that you all are maybe doing or asking as she's kind of going off? I imagine other people are coming to you, Apodex, as you're kind of saying their hellos, some coming up and showing their respect because of the idea of the sign of the bronze bullies. Others you can see kind of keeping their distance, kind of eyeing the whole group, not quite bought in yet, as they've taken Apex's body to prepare for the ritual, the 3-day ritual. Anything that, yeah, go ahead.
Fitz is giving out bronze bully flags to everyone who makes eye contact with her. And is attempting to like pet and play with like the little baby Leonin, who are definitely like cat sized, like house cat sized.
They're like your size. They're literally like the size of Fitz. So when you try to pet one, they like kind of snap at your hands. And but you can tell it's like a playful snap.
I think
snap.
It's like a dance.
Yeah,
we're just having a great time.
Proxenos would after Apodexis finishes his important talk with the matriarch, he would try to find a moment to speak to her. Matriarch, my name is Proxenos, and I'm here to see what is happening with the Acroian troops and seeing what the severity is with the war with these hyena men at the moment.
Yes. And as you speak with her, in the background, little Fitz is just rolling around in the dust as these cats are like pouncing on her. We don't know much. We only know that you, and she can tell that you are an Acroian. You know that we aren't the best of allies, and that sometimes our groups war with the elves on the borders of your territories and ours. And rightfully so, your kind has done our kind ill, and vice versa. These are the ways of the lands. But it seems your ruler thinks great harm is coming to all of Theros from the Dark Gates. And we have now seen enough evidence for this to be true. And so, if Brimus says it be so, there may be time for an alliance. Not quite a truce, because they're not really at war or anything like that, but there may be some chance to work together for the best of both of our kind.
I would like to see that. And I was planning to offer my assistance, and if the others wish to assist as well. This does seem a very pressing matter.
What I would...
Oh, sorry.
Nope, go ahead, Persis.
I was asking from Nick, because I had imagined you and her speaking privately, mm-hmm. but was that trying to throw it to the group? Or are you... having private conversations.
Unless someone says private conversations, we always assume they're pretty much standing within earshot.
It's in the earshot. The others can hear it. It just, he was just, Proxenos was already thrown out there that he was planning on helping.
Mm-hmm. So yeah, through this, Persis has been very, very careful to have like a schooled neutral expression. Like erect posture, kind of in diplomacy mode. But she overhears this and this, I think we would be willing to offer a gesture of goodwill in helping you to deal with your problem here. Hopefully that extends some kind of trust. Peoples all over Theros are in danger, and we need to support each other.
It is not I who will make the decision. The the word must come from on high. And so our groups wait. I can journey to speak and to share on behalf of Baos that you have come. I believe, are a good omen. I say omen because you will not find us praying to the gods here by any means, but we do understand that they have their hand in all things, and we would be foolish to not consider their relevance. And so the most that I do as a matriarch is what I was planning before you showed up was to journey. And she said this within everyone, within for Apple to hear as well, to go to the sun mirror, to look into the reflective waters, and to just meditate and see if I was to hear anything, to see anything. I believe that you're showing up this time, this bronzed one of our own, being an Anvilrot. It is enough for me to know that I should speak to Brimus and share that that Baos believes that we should go to war. But I will ask Apo, if you may go on my behalf to see if you find any other confirmation or good omen of your own. Maybe it is time that you look into the sun mirror.
As you wish, Matriarch.
I do not know if you all have the time, but tomorrow we will commence celebrating the life of Apex. I understand if what your responsibilities are not, do not able to allow you to stay for your uncle's celebration, but I leave that up to you. Will you all be here for that?
Looking over to Apo and I leave that to you, Apo.
We will be here for the commencement of the first day. And then I will go up to the sun mirror.
All right. Anything as you're taking thing in, I know kind of seeing what everyone's doing right now. Only person papers, if I'm thinking in my mind, I don't see right now is Telmoon and Leto and Taroxes. Anything from you all that you've done since your time here in Baos?
You're muted.
Oh, you're muted.
No. Yeah, called me first, so I'll go first. I mean, Telmoon will try to be respectful. He did respect as much as he hated how noisy that stupid lion was. He did respect his fighting prowess. So he would be kind of around for some of the festivities, but as soon as it gets like drinking and partying, he'd probably try to go out into a field by himself. Not too far, but like just enough to be able to shove his family rapier into the dirt and then walk a couple paces out and practice his new forms with his new slightly heavier rapier.
No.
It's not magical, so it has just like a really thick ridge spine so that you could shove it through armor and such. So he just needs to get used to the weight. It's not gonna be as quite of a fluid dance. It's gonna be much more violent in and out. But he's just getting the rhythms while he leaves his other rapier to watch because he's waiting for it to say something. Because right now it's just being a punk.
And so that next morning, maybe we pick up on him kind of practicing at the crack of dawn. You start to see that the ritual is commencing as those who some Leonin already returning from their early morning hunt, carrying their collections, they begin to kind of file around and growl and gruff and roar as the body of Apex is kind of carried through and around the pride along the, like, the, they're not like streets, but, you know, aisles of tents, and eventually making their way up to the den. And Mikella has asked for Apo to say, to kind of like a kind of eulogy, like, is there, what does he say about his uncle, kind of before they kind of lay him to rest in, and for the, what they're gonna do is for the next 3 days they'll keep him kind of, before they kind of put him in a wall, they'll keep him kind of wrapped and on, and somewhat on display as all the festivities. So you are kind of kicking off the festivities. And actually, before Apo speaks, any of his party are able to share and talk in front of all of this kind of sea of Leonin, and share if they want.
Proxenos is in the background. He's actually been studying the seasoning and spices that they've been using for the meat and helping out with the cooking.
It's mostly dirt.
Interesting.
As you say that, as he says that, as you walk away, you notice one of the Leonin, like, looks at you and is like, because, like, it's like, I imagine, like, Apple's like, it's dirt, like, throws dirt on, like, whatever, and then, like, one of them, like, has, like, these spices and was like, kind of looks at you like Proxenos, like, don't listen to him.
Itz has made, has taken the last half of the day yesterday to make, like, a, not quite a tombstone, but like a memorial type stone. And she used the quill of Ifara, so it will never come off. So it's permanent and it will be understandable to anybody who reads it, no matter what language they speak. Mm. And it is like an epic drawing of like a power pose and a couple of his like catchphrases. And it says, a true warrior to the end. He lived and will not be forgotten.
Love it. And so that will go in the, on the wall where they place him. And Fitz can see that scattered throughout the attendees, a few of the Leonin wear some of the children especially wear their little flags. They've kind of like taken them off the sticks, but like wrapped them, you know, somewhere on their bodies. Apex, and then so Mikella begins and she says, Apex, he was at the heart, like, he embodied the heart of a hunter and of a warrior. And there's like gruffs in the crowd. And unlike us, he was willing to go into the great beyond and to live with those in the surrounding polis. And he made a great name for himself. And so, this day and always, we honor him. As I have been told, he and his group bested and brought down the evil Hydra. Many of us have stepped on snakes, but to know that he has killed the multi-headed snake is one of the greatest honors he could bestow us to the people of Baos. And there's roars and cheers all around. And so she steps back, opening it to anyone else. And if not, then eventually Apo would be the one to finalize things. Fitz, you gain a point of inspiration. And Apo stands up on this kind of like mini, kind of like Pride's Rock, you know, looking out over the people.
And he stands, he takes a moment, and he puts it, he hooks his thumbs into his belt. And he looks out at the crowd. My family had said that my uncle was a fool for leaving. And they were right. But fool. Does not end. Into battle willingly, and Apex did that. And Apex also assured me that coming home would be an acceptance, which it has been. So, in honor of my dear, foolish uncle. And he pulls out his sickle. He goes, let the games begin. And he tosses the sickle. And just gives one big, the loudest roar he could possibly give.
And so there's this huge roar, all goes up. And from there, from that morning time through the till the sun goes down, there are challenges of like fights going on. There's like a like there's literally a section of the lands where you can just walk up and get a fight in, a wrestling match. Like anyone, all are welcome. There are areas where there's food constantly being had. There are areas where children, men and women of the Leonin Prides are kind of dancing and celebrating. There is a section where there's drinking, and there are these heavy jugs of kind of like really strong wine, and you notice it's all red. And if you're not looking at the right jug, you notice a lot of times they're taking some of the animal blood and pouring it in and like mixing it into the large vats of wine. Is there any place that you all individually find your place in this scene?
Droxies frequents the wrestling matches, just taking on anyone who wants some.
And so, Throxies, can I have a athletics check? And one of the biggest, yes, after you've thrown around like a bunch of Leonin, there's eventually like one big guy that Apo knows, and he's kind of probably like one of your relatives too, but very loosely based, and he is goes by Grio, and he rolls, what'd you get?
Athletic. 25.
All right, let's see what he is. I think you still beat him. And so it's a back and forth, like a tussling wrestling match, and because he rolled a 23. So with the two more, you're like fighting back and forth, and he's kind of like trying to, he's using claws and everything because it's like trying to like kind of like bite into, get some grip on the slippery bronze. But eventually, how do you finish him? How do you like knock the wind out of him? And
put
him-
I catch him, I lift him up, and I just yeet him out of the ring.
He gets up. Oh, good man. God, I hate minotaurs, but you're good in my book.
Don't worry. I hate them too.
And he goes, well, I think you've bested everyone here, except maybe the one. And he kind of looks at Apo. And he's like, come on, brother. Are you not going to take him on?
Round two.
And Apo rolls.
Athletics. Ooh. To athletics.
21.
Hey, you got round two. 16.
Ooh. So you guys kind of, I imagine, just go rushing at each other and kind of clashing, dust going up. And as they are wrestling, eventually, you know, you're kind of pinning while you're kind of winning that round, Apo. What's Fitz up to? What's Telmoon, I imagine, is going to rejoin with this new weapon. He's heard nothing from his blade. Persis, Leto, Proxenos, what are you all up to?
Fitz is in the crowd with probably the youths, still teaching them how to do the wave and giving them tips on marketing strategies and branding, and how to design a logo.
Yep.
And all that stuff.
So an inspiration point goes to Apo for winning that round. Everyone is like, ah! like the first win, like the people are very like excited for Apo again. Like they're call- that doesn't mean you have to do it again, but they're like calling for another match of that.
Leto would have to do
the whole raise his hand thing and the whole Rocky ending thing.
Yes, I love it.
And then he'd look at Taroxes and go, "Culture dictates we give the crowd what they want."
Best 2 out of 3.
Oh, man, I want to use Giant's Might so bad.
that's 15.
So that's a nat 20 for a 29.
Ooh. So the nat 20 counts for 2 rounds as Taroxy's kind of like, boo, boo. And so as Taroxy's kind of like, the next round just dominates. And he kind of see you kind of get tossed, not gored by the horns, but like, you know, over the top, get flung. Though at this point, everyone's been excited and just antsy for a fight. They just go rushing Taroxes. So like there's a mound of Leonin's climbing over Taroxes as he's like punching out and throwing them off and kind of like just crawling over him. Back somewhere, Leto is sitting and you begin to hear the God of Secrets. And he doesn't seem to be talking directly to you, but talking, and just you hear him saying, eventually the time of silence shall come. Unfortunately, the only way to save them all is I will have to disconnect them from all of their gods, from all of their worship. The time of the silence is at hand. And so you all are kind of enjoying the festivities as almost like through the whole first day. You know, there's this kind of beautiful sunset in as the festivities are going on. And you all know that you'll probably be leaving the next day to head to the Sun Mirror. The festivities shall continue. Is there anything else you guys want to share before, like, kind of the passage of time takes over?
At the spit roast, Proxenos is helping with carving the meat up, seasoning, and getting the next batch ready.
Nice. And so I imagine he's brought some seasoning from Akros as they kind of like observe, and there's a kind of back and forth to see who's better, like you and another Leonin, like kind of chef, kind of trying to go toe-to-toe over who makes the best meal. Do you want to give me a
Wars.
Performance check?
A performance check, okay.
Unless you think it, unless you see something else like sleight of hand or whatever you think it might be. Like, do you have actually cooking tools or?
I have cooking tools.
Okay, then you can use those then. Let's see. And I...
You still got to tie it to a.
Yeah, you got to tie. Skill. So, yeah, so you tie. So, either I'm thinking sleight of hand or performance.
Sleight of hand or performance? Okay.
Or I guess you could, I could also see nature. I guess.
I do have nature.
No, you still have to tie it to a ability score. You don't have to tie it to a skill.
Oh, you have to tie it to
ability score. So would you tie
when you
it
use
to
a cooking, yeah, when you use a tool, you would tie it to a tool.
Got it.
Yeah, so that would be, you would tie it to dex, you would say?
Yeah, so then that's what I'm saying, dex, not, I'm thinking it's more than, it's more of a...
Wisdom. Okay. That is a dirty 20.
Dirty 20. So your dirty 20 to the nat 20. That this is my second. Oof. So you end up coming up with a great meal, but you notice as you guys are serving, the Leonins are like kind of looking like they're kind of tasting like, but the one that there's more people eating the chef's like meal. He goes, "Don't worry, you've definitely got something there. But let me show you. You might need a little bit of this." And he kind of like helps kind of bring yours like up to par of what, but for the most part, they're neck and neck. It's like really, it's one of those Bobby Flay moments where you're just like right there.
And you know, studying the seasonings that he has, he probably has like a special mixture of different spices. And this is, I take this as a great learning experience. Thank you for this.
And he's looking at the spice. He goes, "Do you know what the secret ingredient is?"
What?
Dirt. But it's a special type of dirt. It's a Reskin dirt. And he kind of like chuckles. And it's like all mixed in. It's like a seasoning kind of mix, a rub. And there's a little bit of that soil that's in there and shares with you that's the secret ingredient. So Apple wasn't completely lying.
Gotta get me some of that dirt.
He gives you a little pouch. Unless there's anything else you want to add over the course of the night, but I imagine like the, as you all, can I have a wisdom check from everyone? I think I'm frozen.
Okay. You're back.
Back. Okay.
Yeah.
Wisdom check. That's a 13.
Okay.
Also 13.
16.
8.
16.
17.
Okay.
4.
So 18 Taroxes? I think that's the highest I heard.
17.
Yeah. Okay.
Taroxes the wise, huh?
Right. Can't let this happen.
There over the course of the night, Taroxes sees in the sky Purphoros moving across the sky with intent, with weapon in hand. And it looks like a giant hammer, but almost like a, but he's using the other end like almost like a pick. It's like sharpened on one end, and you see him moving in the sky, and then like, yeah, he just kind of bursts into stars and disappears. And morning comes, and the group wakes and is preparing for their day to set out on the Sun Mirror. Here we'll take a quick 5-minute break. You guys can decide, use your restroom, you know, get new drinks and stuff like that, and then we'll pick right back up.
Okay. All right.
That's cool, because I need to change rooms. So
good stuff.
I feel like I'm gonna have to end up ganking Proxenos's brother somehow. Like it's gonna come down to a
it's gonna be
champion
bad.
V champion thing. Yeah. Both wielding god weapons and shit.
I hamstring him and walk away.
We just have to embarrass him again.
With a hammer. You know how you hamstring someone with a hammer? You just break the whole ankle. That's a nice femur you got there. Sure, it'd be a shame if I shattered it. Yeah, I don't know how that's going to go, but I feel like Mal's got some funky story stuff in the background that he's plotting.
Seemed like it.
We're just going to have to kill Medius again. It's fine.
It was always going to end up this way.
Was there really a different option?
Ugh. It's all your fault. Nick, you should have just left him dead.
I bet it'll make for a very emotionally charged moment, though. But we got to get through what we're doing now first. Here I am looking at the future.
Yeah.
Like, I guess we are going to take a pause to look for this arrow, but we also committed to joining two battles
before going to arrow number two. We have Pegasi. We can go anywhere we want.
We really have.
It's all good.
It'll all work out.
Yeah.
I don't want to go anywhere where the arrows are. The arrows are not in good places either. But I think the Dark Gates is where one of the arrows. Well, so I think we have to hit the Sun Mirror and the Dark Gates regardless.
Yeah.
I'm kind of excited, especially just for like the meta context of where Mal's taking it, because like momentous events are happening. The tribes of the Leonin are for the first time like coming out to do battle, and the gods are moving, and the Murder King's mobilizing forces. Phoenix is trying to break the cycle of life and death. There's so much happening.
Yeah.
I'll just kill Minotaur, bro.
Dalmamoon really does not care about the surroundings of the world.
Honestly, bro, the Minotaur asked to die. Nick was there. I don't know if you got there in that episode.
I didn't get to kill him. I would have collected their horns and made a nice little necklace.
Dude, the rest of the party wasn't trying to help me. One of the Minotaur ran through, and he was running away, and they were like, no, we have to go in to still catch Baramon. I'm like, he's running away!
Yeah, the
so
key.
I hit him in the back of the firebolt. Yeah. He had the key to the prison. So then when I went to the prison, they were like, oh, he ran away with the key. And I'm like, oh, you guys can't get out? And then one of the Minotaur started talking nonsense. I was like, screw this, and just set the whole thing on fire.
So Talmud's a bad
Apex helped. Apex helped.
Apex was the car that Talmud was driving.
Apex also snitched. He was like, Talmud found some slaves, and I think he's gonna light them on fire.
I mean, he was curious if this was standard. Like, is this stuff that you guys normally do?
All I know is you said you was with it, and you showed you wasn't down. That's all good. He gone now.
Be back.
So I'm not going to besmirch the dead, but all I know is you wasn't right to die no more. He was going to snitch every time we did something.
Oh.
But really, like, you guys, like, nobody's talked about it. So yeah. The only person that really knows is Nikki. It's Vince.
Yeah, I don't even know how that conversation goes down.
Yeah, because Apex took that to his grave.
Yeah.
After snitching. He didn't get a chance to verify.
Yeah, if you don't verbally challenge my atrocities, then I can only assume you tacitly approve of my atrocities.
Correct. Yeah. I missed you so much though, Josh. I was like,
oh man, I miss this game, man.
I was like, Minotaur genocide. Stories.
I miss the best part.
Like, I knew if it was me and Taroxes, we could have broken open the door and then killed them one by one. But since it was me and this guy who was already snitching, I knew I had to get it over quickly. So I just took the
whole thing over. You had to be efficient. Efficient with your slaughter.
Yeah, I don't think I've mentioned it in forever, but I think the first group of Minotaurs I started hacking horns off for a necklace or something. It was like way back when we fought the Marauders, but I don't think it's come up since then. But
yeah.
I got to make Minotaur horn necklaces for everyone.
I'm also super curious on the story of why Leto came back. He was free. He was running away from us for a week. He just
fucking work was like, you know what? We're gonna let you have one day at least.
It's like, probably cool. For the best. But you've been working a lot of overtime.
Yeah, like so. I had to quit Friday's game temporarily. I don't know how long though.
Yeah, Virgil was working 5 days a week now.
Yeah, I'm actually Virgil working was 5.5.
Wow.
Yeah, Saturday, like I get off today at from 5 to 11. That's what I work on Saturdays.
Like nighttime Virgil, or daytime?
I guess that, nighttime.
Nighttime, you wouldn't be here. That's rough, bro.
Hey, they pay me time and a half. That's on them.
Nope. Easy there. Yeah, paychecks, you were stunned for good. 5 rounds in a row.
Fucking what?
And Bosch was stunned for 6.
Okay, almost. Y'all's GIF game had to, like, you gotta step it up. I could not understand what the fuck happened. I was like,
I've given up. I try to, like, go back and figure out what day y'all recorded and, like, listen to it and watch the GIFs at the same time. Because they don't, like, tell the whole story anymore. They be leaving stuff out.
The problem with some of the GIFs is you have to like draw a line between when are the GIFs about the game or when are the GIFs about the after game talk.
Yeah, right. True.
And sometimes like, that blurs.
Like Cassandra going, it's tradition. Something that had to deal with fire and being really smart, I'm assuming, with Homer. Stormtroopers. Hey, some shit's not getting hit.
Being smart was not making intelligence saves over and over.
For 5 rounds.
Why is everyone at 7 HP? Exactly. Everybody.
Because a bunch lot of people went down and then you healed us. You got us with a second level mass cure wounds.
Or okay.
Fourth, something.
I was like,
you got us
seven. What the fuck?
It was bad.
Was that the game? Your guys other game?
Yeah, last Daddy, night. My shoes.
Got it.
I woke there up were, to the gifts there, and I was just like, that can't, none of this can be good. None of this.
There were mind flayers. There was a giant mind flayer worm, whatever that's called.
Oh, the neophilid.
Neophilid, neolithid.
The giant.
Like that.
Yeah.
Yeah, there's one of those.
It was bad.
That is not Max what I remember Max telling me.
And then there was
from that vision.
There was the commander, alternate universe Chelavi, who could cast ninth level spells and did.
Yeah. Yeah, just popped out a Blade of Disaster. No big deal.
Fuck that spell. So good.
Max rolled bad for her, so that was in our favor. But
crazy.
It was
still
a
ninth level
tight
spell that just stays around.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's just epic spiritual weapon with super crits.
And it did super crit.
I'm back.
Please tell me it did it on Bosch and nobody else. Bosch is the only one that can
it was
take
on
it.
Daytura.
It was, yeah, Josh
yeah, it was Daytura.
Yeah.
And thankfully, literally, I would have been obliterated, but I used the blessing of the Raven Queen to literally teleport 5 feet back so I could have the resistance to all damage.
Nice.
So she did crit, but I still only took half damage. And when the Blade of Disaster crits, it does triple damage.
Mm-hmm.
Sorry, what?
That's a ninth level spell.
Ninth level spell.
Wizards have spiritual weapon on steroids.
Tanked that hoe. I still went down. I went down for sure, but I didn't die.
I still died, but I didn't die.
Yeah.
I just Marvel died.
I was very close to insta-dying because I got hit by a Finger of Death spell.
Fucking shit, man.
Yeah, you're like 2 points off or something.
I was 2 points off. And on top of that, I got Mage Slayered because I tried to cast Counterspell and I got hit by a crit on the Mage Slayer.
Who the fuck had Mage Slayer? One of the Mind Flayers?
The Commander.
Kelevi.
Oh.
Yeah.
Bitch.
So.
What's she doing standing next to her trying to Counterspell?
I mean,
or you were your blade thing.
I was the blade singer. I wasn't. I wasn't Veritas.
I was like, "What the hell are you doing?"
No.
Sword, stand where you're supposed to stand.
No, I actually dodged about 4 swings of the Blade of Disaster.
You're the only one that could.
Yeah,
it was rough.
Was this like a survival? Like we got to just make it to a certain point, or was this like we got to kill some motherfuckers?
A little bit of both.
It was a bit of both, but to get the best result is we killed them all.
So we killed them all, and the mages were able to banish Stillhavity. No. At least that alternate Stillhavity.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah,
it was so rough too because Bosh couldn't do anything for a solid like 6 turns because of the mind flayer's mind blast.
Fuck that thing.
Yeah, which I did not realize that it sticks around even when the mind flayer is gone.
Oh yes.
It was bad.
I mean, Bosh still did his MVP job at the very end when he broke free, but if you calculate how much damage we were losing every turn that Bosh didn't do anything.
Duh. I mean, Bosh and that Lance is like the deadliest combo we can come up with.
Bosh, you woke up and was just like, screw it. All of the charges. All of them.
I mean, I used as many as I could, which is 2. But yeah.
And yeah, she'd been softened up at least enough for Bosh to just absolutely wreck what was left of her.
Did anybody die?
Nope.
No.
Okay. That was my biggest concern.
Amazing.
Like,
Wolf Jill.
Close.
Yeah.
Oh, no. I looked. The next morning, I was like, all right, D&D Beyond on my phone. Oh, both of them are at the top of my character list. All right, let's see how bad it is. I clicked Wolf Jill just to see, like, he has to be dead. It's like, nope. 2. Standing at 2. How do you survive?
He was literally in and out of the Neolithic's stomach.
Remember
he'd
that?
He'd get swallowed and then he'd break out and then he'd get swallowed.
Yeah. And eventually the Neolith was getting like stomach congestion and he just threw him up.
Oh, he launched Wolf Jill
at
Virgil.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Okay, that's some injustice shit there.
Oh, by the way, Vamp Jill, he did the thing.
Oh, he actually did his feature now?
No, not that thing. The thing where he does inflict wounds and then the thing dies.
Yeah.
He did it to the Neolith.
Okay, that makes sense.
Yeah. Very sad news also. Bosh lent his hat of wizardry to Leilani so that she didn't like. She was worried about the sun coming out because Stillhavity is the sun. So he lent her this giant hat. And then at the end of the fight, we were immediately teleported and he's lost his favorite hat forever.
So I was curious if you guys stayed around or if it was like.
We had no choice.
Once the battle was over, they were gone.
Yep. Yeah. Yeah, because we also were supposed to ask the mages how they did the spell. Nope, we don't know.
But at least they now know how they beat Stillhavity.
Unless they get a chance to ask the literal embodiment of magic.
Maybe.
Because they were teleported into a liminal space between worlds.
So pissed I could not play Friday. Oh my god. I was like, it was a pivotal moment too. I'm like, oh, this fucking sucks.
Yeah, it was a hell of a
set. I would have gotten like only really 2 hours of sleep.
I try and catch you guys' channel and all the images you guys put. I'm like, what is going on?
Just chaos. That's all the campaign turned into.
Trying to make out what happens in those through the gifts is sheer madness.
All shenanigans all the time.
But it's so much fun, and I'm just so sad I never got a chance. I was like, oh, it's so much fun to play.
I don't know. Depending on what character you would have brought, could have been a fucking mind meld. Like, just nope.
Well, it was going to be that the displacer beast creature thing. I was like,
oh yeah, Max would have had fucking fun toying with you.
All right. So we will jump back in. As you head off on your Pegasi, if you know, Apple knows the lay of Oreskos, and from Baos, it's not very far. And especially on the Pegasi, it's maybe a couple of hours, if that, before you see there in the morning, the beautiful sun mirror before you. It is a crystal clear lake. It is kind of the main watering hole of all of Oreskos, as you can see some of the birds like kind of fluttering off of it, off of the crystal clear waters. You can see some of the beasts that have come to the edge to drink from its waters. And what you know about it is that no matter whether there's a storm raging or it's clear skies, the crystal, the face of the waters never change. There's almost like the sun, when it's out, is almost always, its light almost always bathes on the sun mirror. And you know that in addition to its crystal clear reflection that you get from looking at it, is sometimes, just sometimes, you also see something back or get something back from looking into its waters. As you approach and land, you notice from the scattered trees around, there is one tree that is closest to the edge of the waters. And leaning against the tree, almost like resting, not really paying attention and doesn't really notice you approaching, is a young woman, a human woman. Her skin is a dark olive tone, very smooth. Her hair is very short and kind of twisted. And she is adorned in fine, like, jewelry of gold and possibly other, just not she's not like decked out to the point where she would probably be some kind of noble, but or some higher up, but there's definitely some she's not from poverty. And she sits under this one, a very large, not one of the trees that looks like it could be a built, like one of those structures that I talked about before, but a very large tree in comparison to the others. And it's providing some shade where the sun is already starting to kind of beat down on the day. And she doesn't look off or say anything to you, but you do see her, and then you do see the edge of the water, the sun mirror. What do you all do? How do you react?
There.
And so Proxenos approaches. She seems to be kind of shaken as she was maybe she was asleep, maybe she was meditating, but she looks up and she goes, "Hello there. Who are you?" And you can see she kind of like gathers herself, like she should have been a little bit more alert, but then she realizes there's no like weapons out or anything like that. Her hands kind of reach back defensively, and seem to glow momentarily before she drops whatever magic
No need to be afraid. We're the bronze bullies.
The bronze bullies. Nice to meet you. I am Aduo.
Aduo?
Aduo. I came here, as I'm sure you have come, to seek guidance from the Sun Mirror. I typically follow Kerametra and Nylea. Inform my people I have come. But my brother is here as well. And should be back soon. What do you seek?
And looks back at the metal Leonin Apo and turns back. We seek some guidance in the future. There are lots of things that are happening at the moment, and some form of clarity is what we seek.
As are all those who come to the Sun Mirror. I seek clarity on darkness falling on our land. We have had attacks by monstrous men as of late in my police, my city, nearby. And so I am an oracle of mine, see it my own, and I hope to return with some guidance for them as well.
I see. By the way, I am Praxinos.
Yes, you seem to be an Akroin.
Yes, I've also come here to see how the others from my bolus are doing.
Understood. I am Adwo of Akbulan. It is a small polis. We are a city created of deserters of Setessa, who no longer wanted to live without our men in our midst. We share our power equally between the sexes, and we welcome all. We have some Leodin and Centaur who live amongst us as well.
I see.
I came here a day ago. I guess you can tell that she's easing up a little bit. Proxenos is kind of has an easygoing nature, makes her open to sharing. My brother, I'll be honest, I have learned all I can from the mirror, but I was been waiting for my brother to return, and I am starting to fear the worst. It is unlike him to not be back. He has been gone long. He went to hunt in the tall grass. And you look quite capable, more than I. Maybe you would do me a favor and search for him.
And looking back to the others, anyone want to come with me? I can quickly get to searching in the skies.
How will we know him? What is his name?
Yes, if you call out to him, he will respond to Amari. He is young, only 16 years old, ambitious as ever, armed with his trusty spear, short sword, and shield. You will find him in garments similar to mine. As you notice, she has a colors of green and red in her in a kind of like a cross, kind of cross green, like a shawls that she wears over her chest, her stomach exposed, but then like a long, almost like a breezy kind of gown that allows one leg to be exposed for agile movement. She has on sandals and then like her adornments, but so those colors would match. His skin tone, the same.
How old does this woman look?
She appears to be no more than 25.
They just happen to be up here by themselves.
Got a question. The names sound familiar to my character. He's from Satessa. He grew up in the orphanage there.
The names sound somewhat like names you might find that might be originating out of Satessa, but they don't ring a bell in terms of anyone that you would directly know. I understand if you are not willing to help. I should probably be on my way to look for him myself. I just know, I don't know. There's just a sense of dread is filling me, and you seem to be a good omen in terms of being able to help.
Why would we not help? We should be able to easily find him. Yes. We can fly.
He should not be. If you can fly, yes. It would be much more dangerous for me to go on foot. You should be able to find him. He has not, like I said, has not been more than a day. It's been just more than a day. But he could not have gone far. And if you can fly, then you should be able to find him, as the land is flat and open.
Proxenos moves back a few steps and transforms into a great raven.
She's kind of, your magic is quite strong.
And waiting for someone to hop on is back.
I look at you and then walk to our Pegasi. Who carry us?
Taroxy flexes the wings just immediately.
I hop on.
Okay. And Proxenos takes off to that direction.
As you take off with Proxenos kind of guiding the way, Proxenos, can you give me a survival check based on your giant?
Okay. It should still be the same.
Yeah. Unless the raven gives you it shouldn't give you anything for survival.
It shouldn't. 22.
22, nice. Now, from your... I'm going to take your lead on this, Proxenos, as a giant raven, but I'd like a perception check from you, and I'd like to know everyone else's, passive perception. Without me looking.
9.
Okay.
14.
18.
So roll perception?
Mm-hmm. Okay. You're going to roll perception.
That's 16.
So right now you're heading in the right direction. You're able to kind of survey and looking over, and maybe you spot something. But what'd you get for the perception?
16.
Okay. Anyone higher than 16 with a passive perception? Leto, what you got?
18.
Okay. And so what you notice flying over the land here, it doesn't even, I'm talking maybe 20 minutes as you're flying there, as the Pegasi neighing and following this very large raven, is you spot the young boy. For the second, it's tough for you to catch him. But he is, you see his head kind of poking above some tall grass. I lost sight of him. And he seems to be moving maybe 30 to 40 feet away. And he has his short bow in hand, and he's aiming at something. And quickly, Proxenos, what you're able to see is that it appears to be a coiled serpent-like creature, almost like a small dragonoid type thing, drake-ish creature, but with a long neck sleeping in the grass. Now, of course, you all are in the sky, so how you approach this is up to you.
Hey, Nick, how high up are we?
That is a good question. I'm guessing that if we are trying to survey the land, we're probably at least, I want to say, 100-ish feet up.
That's what I would think about.
It'll be easy, just Mexican flag it, just that one's first.
Upon seeing this, though, it's clear that this coiled serpent is a creature and not a animal, or like it's not just a regular animal.
Yeah, it's a type of creature, not that you've ever seen before. It is definitely large. I'm going to use him. I know he's a little bit older than what I perceive, but this is the young creeping up until I find his actual mini. And so right now, you all are essentially in the sky above. I'll just use that Pegasus to symbolize all three of them in a general area, surveying from the skies. And you're a big raven. The other three ravens, the other three Pegasi following, I take it. Now, Taraxes, are you on a Pegasus, or are you still flying with your big, like, giant wing?
I was using the wings.
You're using the wings, so yeah, he's kind of
flying over here
in the back there, trying to keep up towards the rear there as the...
Just so aerodynamic.
And you can hardly see makes a sound. He is slowly moving in for a shot. He hasn't.
How fucking close does he have to get?
You say he had a bow, right?
What kind of fucking hunter is this kid?
With his arrow, like, I got this. I got this.
He's about 30 feet, but like, yeah, he's trying to make sure he doesn't miss.
He's gonna stab it with the arrow by that point.
Pretty much, yeah, right. Like, he's just gonna be like.
And so
I can't do anything until the raven does something.
The raven is actually moving closer to that because it's clear that the kid's going to throw the spear and anger this thing.
Suddenly he takes that bow shot and he fires, gives it a go and fires the shot. And as it flies off, it hits this thing right in the kind of clavicle and kind of hisses and begins to rise up like part snake, part dragon. This thing like kind of hissing, crying out. He starts to settle up another shot. The creature spots him. And before he can take off, that creature begins to kind of fly kind of and strafe very low across the ground, but without even moving towards him, just starts to like spray out a gaseous cloud in that area. What are you all doing? And as the gas goes out, as Omari's setting up another shot, he coughs in the high grass as it's everywhere, and he collapses over from the poison. What are you all doing?
He failed. I'm just fine. We are. I'm sure we're circling around and diving. I'm sure Fitz is going. Fitz is still riding with me. Are you on no way? Are you on one way? Or are you on your own Pegasus, Fitz?
Well, I do have a Pegasus of my own that I believe
you do.
Sparkles.
So you're on Sparkles. Is anyone on one way with me?
I'm probably me.
Okay. Yeah, I know Apo's gonna want to get in there, so we're gonna circle and try to land in a flanking. Not just all in one direction, away from the cloud.
As we're flying, is it passing us, and can it keep speed?
It hasn't taken off yet, so it's just like lifted off the ground. So what we'll say is, as it goes down, since you guys are going to engage it, roll initiative.
Yeah. Okay. Dive bomb.
Well, Leto was going to teleport down there the moment the Raven got fucking closer than 100 feet.
So when you teleport, how you're teleporting close to Omari?
Yes. Okay. And I will be using one of my psychic die for this.
How about you? Are you staying Raven, Praxinos?
Or
are you...
He's still staying Raven, and he's currently diving down.
Okay. I have to
be wild shape midair.
You know I'm gonna do something stupid.
Yeah. I'm just gonna strafe by low enough so that you don't die right when you do something stupid.
I'm gonna get as close as I can and punch it.
So you're diving down towards this thing. So everybody's 100 feet away. Right, on there.
Yeah. Yep. And those of us that are leading a Pegasus
need who's to on, who's on the yeah, who's on the same Pegasus? Who is it fits on her own.
Apo's on the back of one way with Telmoon.
Okay. Yeah.
I think that leaves me theoretically with Nazari on the other, on the last one.
With Pegasus?
Mm-hmm. On no name,
I guess.
Yeah, yeah. No name. Oh, have we actually named him no name at this point?
I think at this point his name has been no name for so long.
I think it's pronounced no name. Noname.
Yeah. All right, I'll be right back. Let's roll some initiative. I just want to grab something really quick.
Okay.
20.
Oh, more things to murder us with.
He's going to go for the god message. Hand. Here just... we go.
Okay.
No, nah. Where's the accent mark in Noname?
It would be the E.
Where's the tilde? No, Nanye.
It could have the two dots over the last E.
The umlaut.
There we go.
The umlaut.
Yeah. Bro, you teach teach AP English to 42 kids.
I got honors English. I don't teach it. They're not going to trust me, AP. What are you talking about?
I mean, honors still bad. Got to do 42 times essays, bro. I'd be burning them up. Use the verb. I like that. Let's go ahead. I see a period. We're good to go.
Oh, no. It's going to be good right material. Now. No, right. It's good. Right now, we're doing Perks of Wallflower. We're going to do some Great Gatsby. We're going to do some Watchmen.
Multiple choice exams. That's all you get.
Yeah. Watchmen is actually on the AP list. So I have a whole class set. Watchmen, Persepolis, Mouse, Fun Home, what else? V for Vendetta from Hell. Look at Troy's face like, what?
No. Bruh, that's the way I think what that sophomore year? I don't remember what they forced us to read sophomore year. I think I just refused.
Oh, I get to do that with my freshman this year with the honors class. So
freshman.
Oh, right, freshman.
Oh, that was like Romeo and Juliet nonsense they used to make us read freshman year.
We're going to be doing some Macbeth too for freshman honors.
Macbeth is beautiful. I did that. I had to act that out. And we had to get those Shakespeare for Dummies books where they translated it to regular English on the other side. Seventh grade, because we just did not understand what the hell they were saying.
No, if you want to read a really cool adaptation that's like... It's 1980s hip hop New York flavored Prince of Cats. That is one of my favorite, and it's from the point of view of Tybalt. And when they do like a duel, like a sword duel, there's the duelist. Get it? The duelist, and Romeo is at the top, and then Tybalt is like going. It's so cool. Yeah, it's one of the coolest adaptations from the point of view of like, the bad
A24. Guy. Is that any good?
I haven't seen it yet. I need to see it. I need to see it. Because I heard it was amazing.
On the list, sure. Should we write down our stuff? Or he'll call us one by one. It's fine. He doesn't want to read it.
I mean, and the coolest thing too is like out of that class of I think 42, there's like 23 of the girls want to play D&D for the first time.
All right, so that like, sounds like a nightmare.
Yeah.
No way, I'm leading 14-year-old girls in a D&D game.
No, 30 of them signed a petition for me. They're like, we want to start the D&D club. I'm like, we already have a D&D club. They're like, oh.
Do they insist on calling it the Hellfire Club?
Yeah.
They almost did. I'm like, unless y'all can name an original Hellfire Club member from the X-Men comic book, which is where they get the name from, then no, you cannot call the Hellfire Club. And they're like,
all right.
What?
I've got 11 for Taroxes is what I think he rolled. Apodex is what you get.
Yeah, 14.
Fitz.
You're muted.
14. Also 14.
Okay. Telmo.
30, 20.
Proxenos.
16.
Leto. The man.
29.
Oof. Nice. Persis.
Solid 4.
4. And Nazari will be out of this one.
Bring the rear. No problem.
All right. Leto, the man.
No, this her brother. What you mean she gonna be out of this one?
Who's out of this one?
Nazari is Ohan's character.
Yeah, Nazari is Ohan's character. Adwell. Adwell did not come with you all, so you guys flew away. Yeah, she's waiting for you to return.
Oh, my bad. Nazari. I was never gonna get that. Never.
I thought she came with us. She'd be like, no, y'all can go get my brother.
Really? He literally said, I'm about to go right now to go get my brother. And then she was like, oh, you guys are going to go? Cool.
She's like, yeah, so can I'll you go?
What the hell? I'm with people in this world.
Hey, man, it's one of those things about D&D that you just, it's just the way the world is. It's right. Like, people meet you and go, can you just go do this for me?
Oh, my back.
Every quest giver in the world is the same way. They're never going to go on the quest themselves. Like, I mean, but it kind of makes sense. It's like,
what happened to good old GTA where you had to keep the quest giver alive?
Right now, you got to keep him alive. Oh, it would just be worse if you had to keep her alive, too. All right, Leto. As you kind of teleport down there, what do you do?
First, I want to check if he's still fucking alive.
He does appear to be breathing. And he is... His breathing's labored. But he's not looking good. His skin is like dark veins are like kind of rolling through it. It's definitely a poison. He's down, not dead. He's essentially what you would call he's making death saves of his own. You know, yeah.
Great, awesome. Fuck. Kind of fucks up what I wanted to do.
He's kind of like he's like feverishly breathing, and he's kind of like beads of sweat coming down his brow.
I can't do shit to help this poor kid, which really sucks. So, I will stand in front of the kid and in between him and this fucking serpent with wings.
Yep.
And he twirls his fingers and one of those green, starry-like daggers appears in his hand. He's just going to throw it at this thing's face. Yeah, that's going to hit. That's like 17 on the die.
Okay.
Plus.
It's going to hit.
9? Yeah.
So the dagger slams into the kind of the creature. Well, actually, see what the damage is. Yeah, let's see how we do. All
right, so it's D65. I'm rolling sneak attack on D&D Beyond because I ain't got 5. 19 psychic damage.
Nice. So the creature's about to exhale another breath of gas as it sees you there. And before it can let out, you land a knife right into its chest, the soft spot under its underbelly. And it coughs out and hisses as it starts to flap these very thin, leathery green wings and lift off the ground as it takes all that damage and is trying to like recover, flapping wildly. Anything else before we move on to Telmoon?
Oh, that's all.
All right, Tomoon, you are up.
I have to use my action to fly.
Yeah, I just think you're 100. Yeah, you're 100 feet away. So yeah, you're.
Well, that's what I'm saying, but I have to use my action to control No Name or to control.
No, you know, I will say unless you're doing something like you got to pull off a maneuver that would use your action. So otherwise, you guys have gotten these horses have got comfortable with you, where you're pretty much you're using them like your movement.
Okay, so it's 90 feet. We're just gonna get as close as we can.
Okay,
but that's not far enough for me to stab this dude. So I'm just gonna go ahead 10
feet out, because you're on there with Apple, right?
Yep, me and Apple. We're gonna be 10 feet out from this dude, and then Talmoon will just go ahead and spark his S-stock against the guard of his rapier.
Okay,
and use that to light a little fire and toss a firebolt at him.
Okay. This little flame flickers out, flying towards this creature.
I'm assuming a 26 hits.
It's gonna hit.
And that is 13 fire damage.
The fire kind of it's the creature is taken off guard by its, you know, it would seem to be really paying attention to its attackers on the ground as it's starting to lift up, and then suddenly it turns hissing, and then fire slams glancing into the side of its face, rolling over it, causing it to kind of drop as you guys are kind of coming in hot. Takes that damage and is still kind of alive and trying to find its bearings here in this moment.
Right, and as a bonus action, I will go ahead and use a third level spell to cast magic weapon on my S-Doc, and you see it to start to glow dully.
Nice. So the stock weapon starts to kind of imbue it with power. At this moment, the drake with its kind of like slithery snake-like tongue. This isn't quite a dragon. But it is dragon-like. As it whips around, give me one. It whips in its head, and as Apple, you flying in, you and Telmoon, you three, it just is able to blow out that breath. Con save from all three of you, for all three of you saying the Pegasus as well.
Yep, I knew one waste time. So,
can I just say that even when Apple is literally doing nothing, he still finds himself in trouble.
It's true. Absorb elements is a reaction though, right? And that was but is it poison?
You already take half half damage because you're Amble Rat, right? Or do they take full damage from being poisoned?
Yeah, it is not. That's the one it doesn't do.
Okay.
Everything else but that one.
All right, that's 20 from Telmoon and 22 from Norway.
All right. So, Norway, so ooh, the 19. Horse. 19, nice. All of you.
Oh, sorry, one way.
One way. No, all of you beat
no
it.
Way.
So all of you will only take half of the damage, which is 24 points of poison damage.
24 is half of the damage?
Yes.
Oh. The hell was this boy hunting?
As it breathes out, it then
Apple, you use absorb elements to
no
take
it,
water,
it can't
oh it doesn't use, take poison.
It's the only one it won't take.
It begins to fly away from you both, kind of like now you're chasing it, but it only flies 40 feet, so it's 40 feet away from this leads us to Proxenos.
Okay, as Proxenos was diving down and sees the kid fall into the ground and Leto protecting him, the kid is going to receive 10 points of healing.
From the sky? Are you doing like a...
It's the Balm of the Summer Court. I can... When I see someone 120 feet away, okay. I can heal them.
Got it. Okay. So, even as the Raven. So he's going...
In your life, have you healed us for 10 points?
10 hit points of healing and 3 temporary hit points.
So Leto has thrown that dagger, and it's landed in the dragon-like creature's neck, and as it kind of flies over, he steps back and he looks, and he sees the boy kind of as the black raven is going over. He's kind of glowing as he wakes up. Slowly, his labored breathing as he wipes his brow, like starting to sit up, like, oh my gosh, I'm okay. Proxenos, is there anything else you're doing?
And he is dashing over towards the flying snake. Yep. I mean, it's more like 1 HP and 1 temporary hit point. Get that right.
So he gets 1 HP? Well, I think you said 10
hit. No. Jason's saying... No,
from the NPC gets 10.
Got it, yes.
But when I heal a player, it's like I heal them for 1 HP and 1
yes.
amp.
All right. The raven kind of closes the distance really quickly, and the drake wheels on its heels, and you notice, like, unlike this thing is very small, and also unlike the dragon that you have fought before, Thraxes has those extra 2 limbs and wings. This thing only has its wing, more like a drake. What do I call those things?
A wyvern,
as it turns and tries to use both wings and claws to kind of scrape, to claw at the raven and try to stay airborne. Apodexis, you're right there closing in behind 40 feet away after just surviving the breath weapon.
Your turn.
Now, well, so here's the thing. Telmoon's at the reins, right? Okay, so Telmoon, if you flew in as quickly as you could and you did what you did, then you've got 40 feet of you're at a 40-foot distance. The only thing that I could see you doing, since you can't command the Pegasus, unless you do some kind of like leaping over onto diving down onto Proxenos' raven to get closer, is a possibility.
Sure.
If this was Tails, you'd do it.
You know I'm going to do it. Yeah. Okay. So is that athletics?
Acrobatics check.
Acrobatics. Okay.
That character's on drugs. This one's not.
This one's just chaotically stupid. Ooh. Okay. So that is 19.
That's going to work as you're like, you're. What's your total movement as a Leonin? Is it 30 feet?
It is more 35. Than that.
35. So yeah, you land. So you literally leap and midair as the crow, that raven is coming in. You leap onto the crow's back, land, stick it 2 feet. So as he kind of closes in, now you can even, if you basically can close a melee gap and basically from the raven strike the drake if you'd like.
Sweet.
Unless you want to do something else, you got your arrows, you got all your other stuff. Yep.
He'll swing with the mace. Ooh, nice.
What are you doing?
19.
Mace. That's gonna hit.
Yes. All right, and then I want to do D&D beyond. I definitely don't want to do D&D beyond. All right. What's it? 1d6. Okay. Ooh, nice. So that's going to be 8 damage the first hit. There's only enough for one swing at this point, right? Because they're passing.
Yeah, they're like... Yeah. Okay. I'll give you your second swing at disadvantage.
Okay.
First one collects, hit him for 8.
The next one is 17.
All right. 17 hit. No, 17 misses. I'm sorry. Just okay, misses. Yeah. As you just miss, Fitz, you're on your own Pegasus. Now, Fitz, give me a perception check.
That's a natural 20. Ooh. Or a 22.
So this is all high grass around you, and what you see, Fitz, is that from the high grass closing in, what the group had not seen before is hyena men from two different directions. Kind of like in that scene in Jurassic Park where you can see the top of the tails of raptors. Because you're all like on the ground. Leto and the boy are in like grass that's up to like their head. So through that, you are the first to notice it in the 6 seconds. There are streaming, there's movement, and it's starting to pick up. And maybe because the stream's starting to pick up and the grass is starting to kind of collapse underneath, you see that there are at least six, about eight path streams moving towards Leto and the boy in the grass. And from what they appear to be hyena men.
Okay. I'm gonna shout, look out! Hyenas behind you! And I'm gonna cast from my, I think I'm within range. I'm gonna fly down so I'm within 60 feet of one of the groups.
Okay.
Of hyena men. And I'm gonna cast Shatter.
One group here, one group there. So I imagine this group closest.
Yeah.
Yep, and you can cast Shatter.
Give him the old bard special.
A con save.
Yep, to all of those hyena men.
And that's a 16.
One is going to pass, two are going to fail, and then the leader. So three of the main groups fail, and there's one bigger, kind of nasty-looking hyena that passes. But all three of those are going to take full. The first three group, no. There's one with, like, an orange frill on his head. Is the only one that passed.
21 points of damage for anyone who got the full brunt of it.
Oof, that was all three of the hunters. 21. So, as the shatter, like, blows them down, they damn near collapse trying to stand back up. It blows, like the grass into open and, like a whole area where they're fully exposed now. And the three seem to be extremely dazed and out of it, and not doing well at all. The leader would take, what, half of that? So, another 11. All right.
And as a bonus action, I would like to cast Unsettling Words.
Okay.
To the leader of that hyena group that I just attacked.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Do I need to make another save?
I'm going to say, wow, your men are really weak. You must be a really shitty leader.
Just let us know when he makes his next save.
Got it.
And I'll roll a d10.
And so you kind of hear this, like this kind of yelping, like laughing in the tall grass. One of that one kind of looking over and snarling at you. This leads us to from Fitz to Taroxes.
Alrighty, how far am I from the Drake?
Everyone is 100 feet. Was 100 feet from the get-go. The raid tried to move away from you, so you're still 100 feet, Taroxes. But right. You are close. You're 100 feet from the Drake. I'd say you're probably still 100. Like you're 100 feet in the sky. So yeah.
Right. Yeah. No. I'll just beeline dash for the Drake.
Okay. So how far does that get you?
60 feet.
60 feet. So about 40 feet away. All right, so he's like about to get in there. And his next kind of dashing forward, Taroxes is kind of closing that gap. If there's nothing else, then we move to Persis, who is on that Drake, on that horse over here, 100 feet away.
Do me proud, to Persis. Rain death from above.
for sure. Yeah, Persis is close enough for the only spell that matters. Let's try to finish off the ones that Fitz started on. Nice. Fireball.
Oh, there it is.
Yeah.
Raining down fire from above. Dex saves for all four.
Yeah, they need to make 17.
And Fitz, you get to roll your d10 to subtract from the leader.
The leader succeeded. The rest of them failed yet again.
Minus six. Does the leader still succeed?
Subtract six.
He will fail as well.
Amazing. <Yeah. laughs> That's 29 fire damage.
Oh, yeah.
Woo.
So, all three of the Leonin as they're, I mean, Leonin, the first, Leonin. Yeah, the gnolls, the Heinemann, you know, as this fire, as this, what does your fire look like? What does your fireball look like, Persis? As
it, oh, yeah. I think I talked about it in the other, in the attack on Barrowman, but it's like this, it kind of looks like an armillary sphere at first, like it blooms out and it's like these rotating bronze discs. And it looks real similar also to Eldritch Blast, but it flies out and then just like explodes in bronze parts.
So yes, it blows out those bronze parts. Those fragments and of those Leonin, of those gnolls go flying before they become incinerated. Just gone. The gnoll leader gets thrown back and he has this kind of like a bone carapace kind of shield that came off of some kind of creature that had a husk, gets thrown on his back, and you see him getting up and his face is all like burned and like kind of like steaming as he like picks up his glaive. And there seem, unlike most creatures that you've seen, he looks weak. He's badly burned, but unlike any other humanoid you've come across with a reservation for their own life, this thing doesn't have it. It has a fervor and a madness in its eyes, even though it must be in extreme pain and close to dying.
Okay, let's try and help him with that. Bonus action, I'm going to quicken Eldritch Blast.
Oh, shit.
Come get some, Bebop.
Let us see. That's a 17... and more. I don't know, does 17 hit?
17. Let me make sure. It does.
I want to split these up. You might kill them on the first one.
And the last one's a natural 20.
Jeez. All right.
Yeah. Let me roll that damage. Well, let's see. I mean, the minimum is going to be, because I have Agonizing Blast, it's 15 plus what I roll.
How do you finish him?
Just I see that, like the look in his eye, like he's not going to give up, and just hate emanating, and it's reflected a little bit, but dispassionately, as the blasts rain down on him and just batter him into the ground.
And he's kind of like, hey, that shield kind of like collapses, and his kind of hind legs kind of collapse over. And the body shrivels and dies. That entire group, and there's an entire section from above that everyone can see the devastation in the tall grass from Persis in that couple of this few seconds. That group is no more.
That's my turn.
As this happens, who was turn was Persis? We move to the top of the next round with Leto.
Yeah, how do I top that? I don't. Leto's just going to check if, since the winged fucking creature is flying away and there is fireworks behind us.
He's like, yeah, it's like pretty much you guys are, like, I imagine him strafing over and then behind you is just this huge boom. Like, that fire just goes out.
We're in the middle of now. I'm going to help the kid up and ask him, can you walk? Can you run?
Yeah, I can. I could run. And he kind of takes off in like whatever direction you're like leading.
Okay. I would like to try and do a perception check to see if which way any other enemies are coming into, and then going the opposite.
Yeah. Now you've heard Fitz call out, so you know there's enemies in the brush. But I like that. You don't necessarily know where they are, so they're gonna roll. Their leader's gonna roll stealth. Give me a perception check. All
right. So plus eight. That is 18. No, 17.
Okay, you do beat him. You just beat him. So you can tell that they're, as you kind of grab the collar on Amarius, he's about to run directly forward, and you can see the grass kind of moving kind of maybe 30 feet away from you, and tell that they're coming in on you that direction, spinning him around a different...
All right, little bear, this way. Let's go. Okay. And I am dragging his ass.
All right. How far are you moving?
I'm going to move my full 30 feet, but if he can't keep up, I'm going at his pace.
Okay. So you guys end up moving about 15 feet.
All right.
Maybe 20 feet. All right.
You want dash drag him or?
You want dash drag him?
I'm not that strong of a person.
Got it.
All right.
I got a four in it.
Tell Moon you're up.
All right. Tell Moon.
You're on this thing. I mean, you're in. You guys are in melee distance.
Well, I'm not. It's 40 feet away from me.
Why aren't you on the same?
Apo jumped onto. You're right.
I'm sorry. I'm tripping. Yeah. You're right. Thank you for being honest.
Yeah, but what if I can't?
But you close that immediately on this turn here if you want to.
Yeah. So I'm on it. Can I? Do I see? Like I heard Nikki. Do I see what she was complaining about?
Yes, you do see the other group down below chasing after the folks on the ground. So you have the Drake or the Knolls to contend with.
Yeah, Tomo's gonna go ahead and have how far are the Knolls, this group, other group of Knolls from me?
You all are, I'll say, because the Drake never really got to get far off the ground. I'll say they're actually about this far off the ground. So they're about 30 feet off the ground. Uh-huh. You are about 40 feet from them. And so your Pegasus is 40 feet from the combat and 30 feet from the ground. So 70 feet. We'll call it 60 feet away.
Okay.
From the ground.
I'm going to have him...
Like at a straight angle.
Go 45 feet. So he's dropping me 15 feet in front of them.
Mm-hmm.
And then just smack him and tell him to fly up and get out of here because he's No Name about to get his butt kicked. He hurt right now.
Smack who? What are you about to do?
No Name. I'm trying to get one way out of there. I'm starting to feel a little tense. Okay. He's hurt. You already breath weaponed him. I want him to run.
So you're gonna fly away on this?
No. I want him to drop me off. Oh, half
drop you off. Got it. Half move to drop you down to the ground. Okay.
And then the other 45 fly straight up. Get out of here.
Fly straight up. Got it. Okay. So he's
and as Tell Moon lands, he's going to go ahead and drive his S stock into the ground, and a wave of thunder and radiant energy is gonna.
Can I get an acrobatics check to land the stick the landing?
100%. Bad picks. Let's go. Not the greatest. A 17 though.
That lands. He's boom like superheroes.
Yeah.
Tearing the brush down, cutting off their advance on Omari and Leto.
Yep. Thor entrance. We out here. And they are going to need to make a what kind of save is this, guys? I've never actually cast this spell before. It is a DC 17 con save.
Okay. Jeez, I'm rolling terribly tonight. Okay, there's going to be one success, two successes, two fails.
Okay.
So the main Pack Lord passes, one of the others passes, and then the main two take full whatever happens.
Okay, so they're going to take 25 thunder damage. And then 18 radiant damage, just rolls of, yeah, I know, I'm sorry.
<laughs> 25 thunder damage, okay. And then 18 on top of that. Okay.
Yeah. If they failed, if they
failed, then he would take half of that, and then still half half of both, right? Which would still be 12
and 9. Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, what spell is this again?
What'd you just do?
Destructive wave. Destructive wave. that's a high level spell.
So only the Pack Lord is alive. The other three have died. Tell me what it looks like as you destroy the group of gnolls.
It is straight Thor's entrance. I am. It's just the ground, and just light is coming up, and I chuckle and look at my sword over it, over my shoulder. Now the Pack Lord is still alive.
There's only one. The Pack Lord is the only one that's still alive here.
Okay, so I am going to go ahead and take this opportunity to spend a bonus action to quicken.
Jesus.
A booming blade.
All right.
Wait, okay, so do I still have half my movement?
Yes. Because okay. You dropped straight down, so yeah.
Yep. Yeah, so I'm going to quicken a booming blade. That is... Sorry,
okay, it's a kicking ass here.
Other thing on it, so it's a 26 to hit.
It's going to hit.
I don't know why I waited to do all that math. I knew that was going to happen. Okay, so let me do it. So it's going to be 7 plus... So that's going to do 15 stabbing damage and 5 thunder immediately.
How do you kill him? Jeez.
Jeez.
This is Brad's bully's work right here. Jeez. Oh.
Yeah, so I'm just going to, as soon as all his people are dead, I just walk up to him slowly. And I just take the S-stock with both of my hands, just stab it straight through his chest. And then as I release, thunder energy just explodes and pushes the blood out the hole that I created.
And it goes flying out the back, and he just collapses over, gone, clean. Oh. Tongue hanging out of his mouth, eyes rolling in the back of his head. You guys are wrecking these things. The Drake is scrambling to get away here, will claw at the giant raven with both of its claws, making one attack for 24. Second attack is 13.
It just hits me.
Ooh, wow! So it's gonna be go roll these.
He a burb.
Yeah. AC, verb AC, not great.
So he'll do 10 on the first strike.
Okay.
And he'll do 12 on the second strike. Ooh. And then he will bite at the raven as they're kind of like locking up in combat for 25 to hit.
Yep.
And then he will
Appo.
22 piercing damage, followed by five poison damage.
Stop saying numbers.
So I'll take, so it drops me out of that, and I take 23 to normal Proxenos.
I'm sorry, you took 23 on top of that?
And then Proxenos will fall.
With Appo,
you will both tumble. No dex save.
Football.
40 feet for
anybody? Gripping this thing on the way down.
36.
No feather.
17 fall. Points of bludgeoning damage, and then the creature will fly another 40 feet.
So it's Appo preferred Elysium, or my boy Proxenos preferred Elysium out here. Straight back to it.
I don't like this place anymore. Fuck it.
So it's still pretty close, but it just went survival mode. Like, these are the wilds. This is a creature just trying to live. Hiss, biting, scratching tooth and claw, and as they collapse out of the sky, it continues flying away. It's still only 40 feet off the ground and 40 feet away. Proxenos, you're up. If you're still up, you're on the ground there. Right after you, it's Apodexis, then Fitz, then Taroxes, then Persis.
Okay. Mission is to rescue the kid, so the snake is completely...
Yeah, we're done if we want to be.
Yeah.
But that thing is nasty. On.
When the fuck are the bronze bullies done?
We literally just fell from the sky. We just got forced to like, something.
See, the dumbest shit.
Work is over. This is what we do for fun.
I have never heard them ever be like, well, I think we're good. We should let that creature go. I think we've done enough damage here. Yeah.
What if it's not a bad guy? You were literally like, he's just trying to live his life.
This might be that Xbox moment where you get the like that first time award, like you didn't kill everything award. Like, yeah. Live and let live, Bling.
I only have two methods of playing: role playing and genocide.
There's no in between.
I'm pretty.
So,
sure
like I said, yeah, this thing
trying to start her dragon army, so I understand the sense of it.
Maybe it'll be friends with the egg that's gonna be my best friend.
It's gonna eat that thing.
Proxenos gets up with half his movement. Ugh.
Okay.
And looks over at this flying snake wyvern thing. And he said it's 80 feet away.
It's it's like 40 feet up and it moved 40 feet out. So yeah, it's about 80 feet at an angle from you. Yeah.
Okay. So Proxenos would use his bonus action to teleport 60 feet.
Okay.
So you see that there's all this mist that comes around him and he disappears from the spot. And 60 feet ahead as he is above where he's below where the snake is.
Below
it. And he's going to cast a spell, and I need a wisdom save from the snake.
Damn it. That is probably not gonna... Eight. It's a fail.
Okay, it turns into a turtle.
So it's like, and it is like, you see it slowly, its wings kind of go out and wrap around itself, and it just begins to like torpedo, like spinning. And as it's falling, it's shrinking.
Proxenos wants to try and catch it.
Try to catch it. All right, so give me a.
This turtle's about to kill Proxenos.
Probably. Yeah.
It's a regular turtle, right?
It's a small turtle.
As it's falling out of the sky, give me an athletics check to catch it.
And he's got to catch it on the run because he only moves 60 feet, so he's got to run and try to get it.
Yep, so it's a little bit more difficult. I'm like making this a DC 20 to catch.
Okay.
All right, let's see those wide receiver skills.
Because you're overreaching. Like, yeah, yeah.
That is not enough.
And so you see it ahead of you go poof and into the ground. Poof. Dust go up and the turtle is kind of on its back. Well, the damage would have been 4d4, so another 6, 7, 8, 9. It would take the damage of the turtle, not the damage of what
it would take the damage of the turtle. And if it drops to 0, then it comes back.
How much is the turtle?
How much turtle got? 4? 1?
Probably.
It's only going to take 11 points of damage, but is that enough to turn it back into
yes.
what it,
a kitten? Yes. Yes, a kitten has one.
Oh, yeah, so the turtle, yeah.
So it would turn back.
So it is on its back and prone, but and like angry, 10 feet of, and angry. Yeah.
Yeah.
That's our boy.
Froxedos is right there. Apo, you are standing up. You can see what he's just done.
That's 18.
What are you trying to do?
Oh, he's taking the mace to that damn thing.
Oh, you're... So how...
Get over there, fam.
Can you get over there, though? Because, you know, he fell out of the sky. He was 80 feet away. He's 80 feet at an angle, but falling straight down, I'm going to call it 60. No, I'm going to call it 70. 70 feet.
70 feet and a half.
You got 70 feet in a beeline, so yeah, I don't know if you can make it in this turn and strike it.
No.
Unless you're going to throw something at it or shoot something. That's different. But I don't know if you can rush over and just bash it.
No, I can't bash it, but I could use that spear. I can chuck that spear at it.
Can.
That's 19 to hit.
That's going to hit. It's prone, too, so you would get advantage.
Get disadvantage.
And that's going to be... Oh, no. Jesus Christ, what do we give this? Oh, that's right, we give it different sense.
Oh, you get disadvantage at shooting at things on the ground. That makes sense.
Let me check something real quick.
Is it?
No, that is right. I want to see if I can do something about that.
Okay. Yeah,
unless you're within 5 feet, then I think it negates it.
In the tall grass, too. It's like falls down. You're trying to see it. Yeah, I can see
it. If I see him kind of struggling a little bit, Persis will react. Things will swirl a little bit around it. It's a thing you can do. Restore balance. Take away disadvantage.
Oh, you're
still 19.
Okay. Yeah. How much damage?
Okay. So then that's going to be
a reaction.
Yeah. That's going to be a total of 8 damage.
All right. Takes the 8. Still alive. Ah, still struggling. The spear is sticking out of its back as it's rising up. Fitz. You're on your...
I am on Sparkles, the Pegasus.
Sparkles, yep.
And I'm going to pull my bow and place a 20-foot cylinder around not my friends, but that Drake.
Okay.
And I will need a dexterity saving throw of 18.
That's gonna fail.
Awesome.
With a 5.
Please enjoy this ice storm while your party is reached. Not that much. Eight. 14 points of ice damage.
So all this ice out of nowhere starts to kind of rain down, smashing. Some of them start to pierce the little leathery membranes of the wings, making it hard for it to take off the ground. Ice raining through as you're flying in over. Do you move at all? Do you get closer?
It's a 300-foot range.
Yeah,
so
I know you got the range, but yeah, I just want to know where you're at. Yeah.
Actually, if it's possible for me to get within 60 feet, I will do that.
Okay, I'll put you within 60 feet.
And then I will, for a bonus action at the end of my turn, cast Unsettling Words on the Drake and be like, you're just trying to live your life, but you ran into us. That really sucks to be you. Now we're going to end ya.
My man was just sleeping. Taroxes, you are on, and I think you have, with diving that all the way to 60 feet last time, you're well within range if you need to fly in and attack.
How well within range?
I say you're 40 feet away.
Okay, yeah. We'll do the old dash and smash.
All right. Kind of rushing in, horns out.
And is it still prone?
I know I'm gonna give you. It's been a long time since you've played, and you spent the most. I'm gonna give you 30 feet. So do whatever you want. Do your turn if you need it. Yep.
You sure?
Yep.
Okay.
It's been a while since we've seen Taroxes in action.
Yeah, I'm gonna do the thing with the hammer.
Okay. It's flying in.
That's gonna hit. Hit.
Oh.
That's gonna be 10 fire. I mean 10 bludgeoning and 22 fire.
Jeez.
This is the bronze bullies I know.
Yeah. Second strike's a 29.
It's gonna hit.
That'll be 17 bludgeoning.
Jeez.
And
Lord have mercy.
20 fire.
If the thing had kids,
they're giving them. Oh my god. It's is mom. It still alive? It is not. How do you do it?
I beat it into a pulp.
Every time it's trying to raise its head and snap, boom, another blow, fire like rolling across it, burning
it. A meteor fell from the sky, landed in its chest, and Taroxes crawled out of the corpse.
And there is the fire kind of blazes off and slowly burns on the brush. There's Taroxes and the bloody pulp of whatever the creature was before. This creature is not even usable for meat tonight. Like, it's like Proxenos is not even going to be able to cook this thing. It's just charred and
it's already cooked. Well done.
That's what I'm saying. It's very well done.
I think I got it.
It looks very crispy.
And there, the bronze bullies kind of show their mastery. Their horses, their Pegasi flying over. Omari turns to Leto slowly as you guys are able to kind of take in the scene. Your friends are great hunters.
They're just really good at killing a lot of things. What the hell are you doing out here?
I thought that I could find the a strong beast to bring down. At first, I figured I would find a lion or I wanted something to be a predator, something that I could best on my own. And then I saw the flying hunting trick and decided it would be mine. But clearly, I have more work to be done to be as good as you all. I clearly was not ready.
That's great. And I'm more wondering why the fuck are you here? Far from Satessa. You could just go hunt a wolf.
We don't live in Satessa. We live in Aquilon. We are an offshoot society.
I know what it is. I live there.
You lived in Satessa. We live in Aquilon. It is not Satessa. It is that way. And he points like to the north. We are slightly different. Some of our cultures are similar. But
is there nothing deadly up there then? Like, why'd you have to come so far south?
We came with my sister to go to the Sun Mirror to find my sister is an oracle in our culture, and I figured I would come for adventure. And you can see that he is not fazed. This was great for him. I will only get better I am quite acute. I have learned from some of the things you have done, though I do not have flying horses.
Yeah, they were a gift. No, you'll get dead real quick if you try to fight anything like that again. I mean, the thing just... One, if you're a hunter, why'd you get so close?
Maybe you are right.
No, you have a bow. Distance is your friend.
I wanted to make sure I did not miss, and the tall grass obscured my vision.
Okay, then get better at aiming and shooting before go hunting.
All right.
And he's just going to take an arrow and pull out his bow and, like, shoot it towards the tree that he was near.
Maybe my family is right. Maybe hunting is not for me.
Well, all right, let's just get you back to your sister. She's worried sick. She sent us out here to find you. So we got to get you back to her first.
And so you all eventually make it back. She is ecstatic to see her brother alive. My brother Amada, you are so foolish. Oh, and she could tell by the way he's come back that something has happened. Thank you. Thank you for helping him. I am fine. I am fine, sister. And she says, well, I appreciate you bringing him back. We need to go home. We have seen enough. But let me give you what I can. And she gives you 20 gold pieces that she has on her. And the brother says, that is not enough. You did not see how great they were. I will give them my shawl. And he takes this kind of like cloak with these like beautiful adornments, ornamentations on it. And he hands it, from his perspective, what would he have seen?
Explosions, Leto showing up all of a sudden.
I think he just hands it to Leto. Because it's so hard for him to take in everything. And what it is, it is a magical, it is an animated shield. But it is made like a shawl, like a cloak. So when you drop the cloak over one shoulder, it animates the shield, the force field.
The border tribe.
Interesting. Does it count as a shield or is it like unarmored still?
It counts as a shield. So it counts as an animated shield. So while holding the shield, you speak a command word and a bonus action. It animates the shield, leaps into air, hovers in space, and protects you as though you are wielding, leaving you hands free for the other hand.
Get them, Leto.
Yeah. The shield remains for 1 minute.
Fitz, do you have any of those Saved by the Bronze Bullies care packages ready?
Duh! And I pull out, like, beautifully wrapped in, like, this little net. It's got Bronze Bullies flags. It has Bronze Bullies honorary bully patches. Oh. And, like, little bows that are in our colors. And I give them each one.
Thank you. I appreciate what you've done for my brother. And I thank you for these fine wares.
Remember, we are nice. Don't let the name fool you.
Is there anyone that needs healing? As there's this glowing, glowing white mist that surrounds Proxenos.
One way out here, running into walls and nonsense.
Yeah, you see that Proxenos' wounds have already begun to heal. The blood and any bruising is just restoring back to normal.
Mm. Oh man, it's like, does anybody need healing? Then just heals himself and walk away.
Looks.
I'm fine.
We all get one HPs with the thing.
One apo.
And one temp HP.
You get 17 points of healing.
Oh, yeah.
Nice.
Talmoon.
Uh-huh.
You get...
Good money, 14. No whammies. Stabbing you next time. 14? No, not damage.
really.
No, you take damage. It's fine.
And can't forget our boy, No Way.
There we go. His name is officially changing. No Way Home.
It's more like, no way, he's still alive?
Yeah. He gets the most out of anyone. He gets 23 points of healing.
Dude, oh, you crap. Heal everything besides like the group way better.
Yeah.
Right.
He's only down one hit point now. Darn it.
Loves them animals. Fuck this party.
Except for them turtles, apparently. He was vicious that day.
And so there's some healing going on, and Adewo and Omari are starting to prepare to head off, but I wish you luck.
Why don't you just make
with also, your did you, oh, go ahead.
Did you happen to see like anything that looked like an arrow? We're looking for an arrow around here.
An arrow?
You're an oracle, right?
Well, have you consulted the Sun Mirror yourself?
No, we on our way. We stopped to help you. We would have done that if we weren't saving your brother.
What I can tell you, an arrow is what you seek?
Look at
arrows?
Where it originally fits? I think there's only one here.
Since you brought it up, Telmoon, can I get
I should shut up forever. Are you sure? Can I get a help action?
Can I just poke next to him and be like, what my friend means to say is...
Can I use athletics?
Punch your way to
Can I have a charisma check?
Charisma I can do. Just
can I inspire charisma? Him?
You can.
Okay. You're inspired with a D10.
Like, it's like a persuasion or something like that. Just pure charisma?
Pure charisma. So it's not persuasion. It's just, yeah, it's just how she vibing off of, like, Telmoon's approach.
And you gave me a 10?
I gave you a D10. You have inspiration.
Okay, that is a 25.
Okay. Sometimes, if you are looking for something, you can... If you're looking for an arrow, show an arrow to the Sun Mirror, and what it reflect back at you may be what you are looking for.
You're right.
I have arrows! I skip over to the lake mirror situation.
And so what do you do at the lake, Fitz?
I kneel down and peer. I'm totally picturing the Lion King when he's in the cave and he's looking over the mirror and he sees like the reflection of his dad. I'm gonna hold one of the arrows, just the regular ones, not the magical ones that I have, over the lake. And I'm gonna say, Lelea, you sent us here to find these arrows. We're not really sure which way to go. If I Marco, you can Polo. We just figure this out.
And as you open your eyes after saying that, advantage, wisdom, roll.
First one's a 4.
Only one way to go.
A 10.
Shit. 10 is literally exactly what I was looking for. And so what you do see in the water is you held a regular arrow over. And in your reflection, everything is crystal clear. The one difference is that the arrow you see in your reflection is something clearly that only Nylea would have created. Only the finest wood, only the finest stone tip, feathers of some kind of exotic bird. On that arrow, the arrow that you see in the water is different. And what do?
Can I reach in and grab it?
As you reach in to grab it, you have to hold the arrow in one hand, and so you splash against water. It almost looks so... It was like it was there to touch, and your hand crests the water, and you don't have the arrow. You still have the one you're holding in your hand, but you still see the special arrow in your hand.
In the reflection only.
In the reflection only.
What does this mean? Can I dip the regular arrow into the water? And try and pull it up and see if it turns into the magical
word? Press it into the water kind of ripples and distorts it. And when you pull the arrow back out, it is the arrow that you saw.
Yeah, Nylea, you make the coolest stuff!
And it kind of glows with a magical essence, and you're like, hey, that worked. And for a moment, you almost turn to Aduo and Omari to thank them for talking, and they're both gone.
Is everyone gone, or is it?
No. Everyone else is there, but they have like, and everyone else even notices they've like already vacated. Like it's almost like in that moment, whether they were able to like get far away, but they're just like not there under that tree.
Oh, it was ghosts. They was long dead. Look out! No way they survived out here.
Not with those hunting skills, that's for sure. At least they got our merch. And I got an arrow! And I'll do like that Legend of Zelda.
She's just like striking that pose in front of everyone.
Now, who wants lunch?
Ooh.
Hold on. Apo, was there something that you needed to do here for your people?
And he walks up to the lake. And he has to look in as well.
And what is Apo? If I had to ask him in his heart of hearts, not asking him a question to answer in front of his party, but like, what is he looking for? What does he expect to see? If there was a question to ask the Sun Mirror, and he was looking for a response visually, what would it be?
He would be looking, when he looks into the Sun Mirror, he's going to be looking for one thing to assure him that they need to go to war. And that would be the golden mask that he sold.
He'd be looking for that mask that they sold and where it is. And as he looks into that water, what he feels, what he starts to get back. He doesn't ask that question. He doesn't say a word. He just stares into the water. And as he does, he sees in his own reflection the old man he sold the mask to. And he sees the old man take the mask and put it on. And the old man is in that water staring back at Apo. And then from within the old man is wearing, kind of was wearing that like kind of old cloak, the one that traveled with them to Akros. He begins to open it, and from within, eyes begin to appear as other return begin to feel the dark waters. And similar to that weird feeling when he was frozen in stone, when he saw the Leonin walking across, Apple starts to see them coming out of the misty water. The waters suddenly become misty and dark, and he starts to see returned coming out of the sun mirror. And as he slowly begins to step back on his paws, he realizes that for sure, confirmed, the old man was Phoenix. And that was Phoenix. But even though he's that moment of just experiencing that, he feels kind of maybe a blessing fall over him. A resistance to fear. He's no longer scared. The answers that he gets in seeing that reflection of the old man, he realizes that Phoenix is moving in the underworld, and he can see that Phoenix has strands coming off of him, and those strands seem to be connected to fate. And those strands are connected to the Nolmen. They're connected to the other evil forces that are moving. And even some of them connect as high up. The last connection, almost like he starts to see a constellation in the water. A connection that reaches to the Nyx. And then he sees a bright light, the water, the reflection of the sun hits right over, and he breaks his vision there. And the only thing that could be that bright is Heliod himself. You now have a minor attunement, even though it's not a weapon. You're immune to frightened. And in these last moments, what do you talk to your party about or share?
Made a horrible mistake when I first met you all. The old man sold the mask to was actually Phoenix. And in the water, I saw not what I wanted to see, which was the mask, but images of Phoenix and Leonin has returned coming out of the waters. And it felt like when I was stone and I had that vision of the return coming. Beg your forgiveness.
Proxenos puts a hand on his shoulder. We all make mistakes, but it's what we do after them, making them, that counts. And this shows more than ever just how much Phoenix has been in the background controlling all of this.
Yes, Apo. What has happened is you cannot change that. I would ask, was this vision metaphorical, or should we start draining local water sources?
I believe the water source is okay for now. But this was not an attempt to reclaim the mask. This was showing me what I needed to see, my my decision to tell the others that war is inevitable. And there is one other thing you should all know. These hyena men, these gnolls, are connected to Mojis and Phoenix.
Well, on the subject of breaking out bad news and talking about gods, I was just going to tell one of you all this, but since we're already on the subject, I overheard one of them kind of talk to themselves. It's one of the voices I don't hear too often, so when I do, kind of stands out. For you, all that worship one of the gods, or multiples of them, might want to get that in as much as possible. One of them says they might have to cut off their worshipers, everyone.
Ooh, who said that?
It was that punk Heliod, wasn't it?
No, stronger like and stronger than Heliod. Heliod just is a child. He rants and raves. I hear him talk about his siblings all the time. This one is more, when he speaks, everyone listens. God of secrets. So it must be
Perforce, the only one more powerful than Heliod.
No, there's older ones. They're kind of like a family, like big brother, little brother, all that. The God of Secrets, Krufix. I don't hear him talk. Ever, really. Whispers every now and then, but when we were at the funeral rite, I was just walking around and I heard a voice in my head saying that the time of silence is coming and that they would have to cut off all the worshipers. And that was it.
That is very troubling news. That'll create a lot of chaos and panic in Theros.
And that's but it also cuts time. Off their powers, if it's true that you worshipers are their power source. Your prayers, your deeds, everything you all do. I mean, hell, Fitz here just retrieved that fancy ass arrow. He cuts it off. None of it means anything. Hell, I don't even know if the items that you all have will actually still be around. I've never heard of the time of silence. None of them has ever uttered that.
And you're saying Heliod will be vulnerable.
Sounds like all of them will be.
I was going to say, what then happens to the gods if they're cut off from their source of power? Will they starve?
I've heard that Krufix is old and wily. He doesn't speak to you often, so it stands out. Is there a chance the old one was simply leaving bait for you? To misdirect and to
this wasn't a direct conversation. I overheard him. It was like eavesdropping on a conversation at a tavern.
Indeed. But in a tavern, you can say the right words for the right ears to hear, to get them to do what you want. If you've spent time in Meletus, then I'm sure the pickpockets, you'd be familiar with a simple setup. If you want to catch thieves, you talk about how much gold you have and make sure they hear you. Just a thought.
But we are talking about gods, not mortal men.
True, but the gods are the best thieves there are.
Men are easily corrupted, swindled. I've done it. I've been the fall of one. I don't hear his voice often. It is Perforos talking about a great creation he's about to do, or how great Heliod's full of himself. It's really annoying, that one. Karametra, how the harvest is going. It's the things that they're good at. I don't hear from a lot of them until they actually speak, and when they speak, their voice stands out. And I haven't heard anyone speak for days. Our entire travel to here has been quiet, which is rarity. I haven't had an actual clear head in 17 years. It's kind of refreshing.
So who was Krufix talking to?
I don't know. Himself, someone else. It was just the God of Secrets voice speaking out, and I overheard it. Figure I'd let you all know before something else happened.
Sounds like to everyone. At the very least, we know that our time has just gotten shorter, and we have to make things happen post-haste. Kind of like begins putting away the cooking equipment. We should head off to the capital, right, Apo?
Yes.
And suddenly, Apo.
Apo just reaches down really quickly and pulls some mud from the bank of the lake, puts it in the pouch.
What does he pull?
Some of the mud from the lake, from the reflection. He just grabs like a paw full of the mud and puts it in a pouch.
And as he pulls the mud from the pouch, he's still holding in his hand when he hears the call of Leonin calling from the distance. He turns, he sees a group of his kind approaching him. And they, as they close in and get closer, they go, Apo, bronze bullies, we are going to war. The word has come down from Brimus. All prides will go. And very far off in the distance, you can already see a very, very far away the flock of the migration of huge groups of Leonids. Your word that you got, you can take back to Mikella, but they've already made the decision. They are putting Apex in the ground a day early to go to war at Baos. And so we see back at that place, Apex is being put into the wall as every one of the Leonin are being armed. The strange thing is when you grab that last bit of mud, Apo, you get a strange feeling. You get another vision looking in the water as the mud splashes. And now you know that all your brothers and all your sisters go to war with you. And in your mind, you can imagine Tyrannica is somewhere out there fighting with the last few remnants of her 200 Acroians. But now she will be backed by all Leonin. But you know that the group that is pouring forth is led by none other than Thraxes himself. You see the red dragon leading the gnolls to war. And as you hold the mud in your hand, the bronze begins to peel away as you turn back into full-blooded Leonin. And we'll crash to black and end there.
All that hard work.
I was going to wipe that on my face, too.
I found the perfect gif.
That's gonna be warping right there.
And Thraxes.
Good gig.
Whoa.
Oh my god. That is perfect.
As you can see, I am not dead.
Good gig.
Oh my god.
Fight.
Well,
who the fuck
so my
shields?
Hammer does less damage to that.
Yeah. Yeah. A lot of our stuff does less damage to that. It flies by itself.
Yeah.
I can't cast slow or haste. Those spells are gone for me now.
Why are those gone?
Because I need spellcasting components for them.
Mm.
So unless I don't think that Telmoon ever learned to cast like that.
Yeah, yeah.
So unless it's a component that he just naturally has, like if it was like cured leather, like, well, he has that, he wears it. Yeah. But like if I need like a firefly or something, I don't keep that spell because he wouldn't know to use it. So yeah, good times, guys. Kitchy got us. Well, of thorns. He can't get past that.
Troy, I believe I'm the only one who uses a shield still.
Yeah, I'm just curious who the fuck uses a shield.
I mean, a lot of people could use the shield.